Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 25th meeting of 2015 in the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. I hope everyone had an enjoyable recess, and obviously some people have been very busy at producing work towards what our business will be. Before we move to the first item, remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones as they can affect the broadcasting system. You may notice committee members consulting tablets during the meeting. This is because we provide meeting papers in digital format. And agenda item one is a discussion on taking business in private. First item today is to discuss taking item four in private, and I seek a member's agreement to do so. Are we agreed? Thank you very much. We are agreed. On agenda item two on the Land Reform Scotland Bill, as the agenda is to take evidence on this bill from the Scottish Government's bill team. We're joined by officials who've been working on the bill and will be hearing from them in three panels. Panel one will discuss the background to the bill, development since the Land Reform Review Group report publication, and parts 1 to 5 of the bill. Panel two are here to discuss parts 6 to 9, and will explore part 10 with panel 3. We'll have a short suspension between the second and third panels. So I welcome everyone to the meeting. Each panel will be chaired by Trudi Sharp, the Deputy Director for Agriculture, Rural Development and Land Reform. Good morning. And joining her in the first panel are Kate Thomson-McDermott, Fiona Taylor, Matt Smith and Rachel Rayner. Good morning to you all. And I refer, to first of all ask if there are any comments from Trudi Sharp about the paper before us, or if you wish to make any short comments.
Thank you. I'd like to make just a short introductory statement, if I may.
Indeed, if it deals with the detail, we can take that later, but a short introductory statement, please.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the committee for inviting Scottish Government officials along today to give evidence on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. The bill, which is part of the 2014-15 programme for government, is the next step on the Scottish Government's ambitious land reform programme and is key to the government's aspirations for a fairer, more equal and socially just Scotland. As the committee are aware, the bill is the culmination of significant work in relation to land reform and agricultural holdings over the last few years. In 2012, Scottish ministers appointed the Independent Land Reform Review Group, who reported in May 2014. They made 62 wide-ranging recommendations, some of which are being taken forward within this bill, and others are being taken forward as part of a wider programme of land reform measures. In 2013, the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group began an extensive review across the tenant farming sector and published their final report in January of this year. Again, the bill takes forward a number of the recommendations that they made. We've worked closely with stakeholders in developing the bill, and in December 2014, the Scottish Government published a consultation on the future of land reform in Scotland. That received over 12,000 responses, with 84% of those being from individuals. After careful consideration of the review group reports and a thorough analysis of the responses to the consultation, we have a bill that contains a number of wide-ranging provisions that are intended to meet those policy objectives. Firstly, the bill deals with ensuring an effective system of land governance and ongoing commitment to land reform in Scotland by establishing a Scottish Land Commission with a commitment to publish and review every 5 years a land rights and responsibilities statement setting out the government's objectives on land reform. Secondly, the bill will enhance sustainable development in relation to land and improve the transparency and accountability of land ownership by requiring the publication of clear guidance to landowners on engaging with communities, introducing a new right to buy land to further sustainable development. The bill also gives greater powers to the Keeper of the Registers of Scotland to request and hold information on the proprietors of land and a right to request the disclosure of information on those in control of land where lack of information is causing harm to communities or individuals. Finally, the bill demonstrates a commitment to the management of land and rights and land for the common good by modernising and improving aspects of land ownership and rights over land by removing the exemption for non-domestic rates for shooting and deer stalking, strengthening existing legislation on deer management, common access, common good and access rights, and taking forward significant recommendations on changes to agricultural holdings made by the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group. A lot of work has gone into preparing this bill, and we would like to take this opportunity to thank the many stakeholders for their hard work and consideration of the policy in the bill, and we look forward to answering your questions today.
Thank you very much. We are at the present time faced with a bill which is extensive, as you see. We have a limited time for questions, and we want to try and get to the heart of some of the things which will help the process. We realise that you're here to try and tell us about the background. So, given that, it seems from what we read that there are many sets of regulations that are anticipated by this bill that will be generated by it. And, you know, we'd like to know why many of these are not set out in the face of the bill, because it's difficult for us at the present time to know the import of the regulations in terms of the policy objectives which you laid out in your speech.
Okay, I'm going to ask Kate to comment on that in a minute. I'll just note that we've been invited to give evidence to the Delegated Powers and Land Law Reform Committee, which will obviously give an opportunity to explain a little bit further. Kate.
Thanks. Yeah. Just in general, as the convener noted, this is a large bill that spans a wide range of policy areas and contains a total of 43 regulation-making powers. It's often the case in many bills that there are areas of detail that are largely administrative and would, in the normal course of events, be left to secondary legislation. And it's also quite normal for the full picture on any legislative topic to be made up of a combination of primary and secondary legislation. Around half of the regulation-making powers in the bill relate to agricultural holdings, so it may help the committee to ask the third panel directly about any regulation-making powers contained in Part 10. Many of the regulation-making powers in relation to Part 5 of the bill, which contains the provisions on the right to buy to further sustainable development, and many of these regulation-making powers replicate those that exist in similar and other legislation on community rights to buy. Obviously, Parliament has every right to scrutinise where this balance should lie, and as Trudi mentioned, we received yesterday a kind of indication of questions from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which obviously we will be answering over the next few days. Certainly, if there are any specific concerns on any specific areas that the committee or stakeholders raised during the Stage 1 process, we will be happy to consider those and try and provide as full and detailed a response as we can on those in due course.
Is it your impression that there's going to be a greater number of pieces of secondary legislation associated with this bill compared to what were required to enact the Land Reform Bill of 2003?
I wouldn't say I was completely familiar with the number of pieces of secondary legislation that were required under the 2003 Act. I mean, I think decisions about when regulations are more appropriate or when it's more appropriate to be in primary legislation very much depends on the policy and the level of the detail of the policy that you are enacting. I couldn't really answer that question at the moment.
No, I just thought it would be interesting to compare, but there was obviously Agricultural Holdings Act at the same time. We're combining these two in one bill this time, so it might be that there's an aggregate number which is similar, but I don't know. I don't know whether anyone does. It would be useful for you to tell us at some point later.
We'll go away and have a look at that and come back.
Thank you. Given that much of the bill is expected to be scrutinised by and then used by communities, landlords and tenants, are you content that it's sufficiently accessible and easy to understand?
Yes, I mean, I would say the Scottish Government take structure seriously and consider carefully the needs of the end user when drafting all bills. The explanatory notes and policy memorandum that accompany the bill should aid the reader in understanding the provisions in the bill and the underlying policy content of the bill. How particular sections are set out will depend on a number of factors that will be considered carefully by policy and legal officials in deciding the final format. Further, generally with legislation, Scottish ministers and other public bodies would seek to aid understanding of the legislation and how it operates in practice by publishing guidance once the bill has obviously passed through Parliament and has been clarified. For instance, Revenue Scotland have guidance on the devolved taxes, and the Scottish Government has published very helpful guidance on the community right to buy under the Land Reform Scotland Act 2003. Again, I'm more than happy to consider any concerns that the committee or stakeholders may have on any particular provisions, and we would happily consider any suggested recommendations for improvement and come back with an explanation as to why things are structured currently the way they are.
Have you had any approaches by stakeholders for clarifications about the meanings of any parts of the bill that we're discussing in these set of questions?
Yeah, we have had conversations with a number of stakeholders kind of over the summer since the bill was introduced, and there are a number of areas where we have sought to provide further clarification. We have done that on a one-to-one basis. Once we have a clearer picture through stage one, if there's anything we can do to produce further documents to help with those clarifications, we'll happily do so.
Okay, thank you. Any supplementaries? Alec Ferguson.
About the question of the regulating powers, very briefly, Convener, if I may. And it's really just to make a point on that. From my point of view, given the role of scrutiny that we have on this committee, it's not really the number of them that concerns me as much as to what those regulatory powers are about. For instance, and we will come to this later, when it comes to rent reviews, we're talking about rents being based on productive capacity. Excuse me. And yet we don't have that on the face of the bill. And I think that's going to make it very hard for us to scrutinise this properly, given the lack of detail that there is. So it's, to my mind, not the number of regulatory powers that are the problem. It's what they refer to. And I just really want to make that point, if I may.
On the point of clarifications, I wonder if we could have an indication from you in a short list of the one-to-one pieces of clarification that you've given to stakeholders. Because it would be useful for us to know before we come to questions with those stakeholders what points they are unclear about.
I'd be more than happy to follow up. Obviously, all of the officials have had various conversations on the various parts, but we could certainly follow up with
that. But a summary of those would be most useful. Right, okay, thank you for that. Land rights and responsibility statement. Mike Russell.
There are, I think, where there are areas in which people wish to see improvements to the bill. They very often are predicated upon recommendations that came from the Land Reform Review Group, issues that arose in December consultation, which appear to have changed or narrowed, and certainly the number of those I want to refer to during the day. Let me start with the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement. I think almost all the people I've spoken to over the summer about this issue are concerned at the narrow nature of the bill's description. It's described in 1.2 as a statement of the Scottish Minister's objectives for land reform. That is different from what the December consultation indicated, and it's very different from what the Land Reform Review Group indicated. And they indicated that this might essentially move towards a proper national land policy. Could you explain the changes that have taken place in the drafting instructions for this bill that have led to this narrowing and the reasons for them?
Yes, happily. First of all, it certainly was not intended to be a narrowing. The Scottish Minister's intentions are that the Land Rights and Responsibilities Policy Statement that was consulted on in December would be the starting basis for drafting up the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement that would eventually be published under Part 1. So it's not intended to be a narrowing from that sense. And I would hope that was made clear in the policy memorandum, but obviously we can take the point away that's maybe not clear from
just, from I just want to make the point that we're working on the basis of what's in the bill.
Yes.
And, you know, in the bill it says a statement of the Scottish Minister's objectives for land reform.
Yes.
Right? So that's what's on the face of the bill. And I think this is the point about secondary legislation. It's also the point about how the bill is drafted. Mm-hmm. It is really important if we're to have confidence, and rural Scotland particularly is to have confidence in this, that it is absolutely clear. So if it's not narrowing, I do think we need to see that on the face of the bill.
We can certainly take that away, and I'll happily discuss that with legal colleagues whether a change needs to be made. But certainly the instructions and the intention is that Part 1, Section 1 would be broad enough to allow for a statement similar to that that was consulted upon. Obviously, we had a lot of responses in the consultation to Land Rights and Responsibilities Policy Statement. It was the highest level of response in the consultation, and there was a high degree of support, over 80% to those. There were numbers of comments varying from general support into some quite detailed comments, and it certainly would be our intention that the policies and principles in the consultation paper, along with the detailed responses to the consultation paper, would be our starting point for taking this forward.
In that discussion with lawyers and others, I wonder if you would take account of a change in development that took place in the Community Empowerment Bill, where there was a reference to essentially external validation of the points. And external validation here would come from the UN FAO's Voluntary Guidelines on Responsible Governance of Tenure. Now, this is a document that has been endorsed by the 700 delegates from over 133 countries. A reference to that would widen this, I think, in the way the LRG wanted it to be widened, and would provide the context where people could understand how land reform policy is set. And that's the high-level statement that people are looking for. So if that is entered in the record, it might be helpful that lawyers looked at this and it entered into discussion.
Obviously, happy to consider any recommendation that the committee makes. There are a wide number and range of documents and treaties and principles that obviously encompass land reform, which is such a broad area. And certainly, in taking this forward, our intention would be to consult further and thoroughly on the scope and remit of the statement. So I'm quite happy to take that away and consider.
Okay. One final point on the statement. Although the statement will be laid before the Parliament, the intention, I think, always was that the statement would be debated by the Parliament. I think that is an issue which also in drafting terms has become unclear. And I think that active involvement of the Parliament with the statement is something also many people would be looking for.
Yes, my understanding is that there doesn't need to be anything specific in the legislation to allow Parliament to debate or consider the statement, but certainly happy to consider.
In terms of permissive debate, but in terms of mandating discussion, that would be helpful in the legislation.
Again, happy to take that away and consider further. Thank you.
Thank you. Points well made. Thank you very much. Looking at the Land Commission now, Dave Thompson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. the first point I would like to raise is about the title of the Scottish Land Commission, as is proposed in the bill. This is a journey we're embarking on, and we've been on this journey for a while in relation to reform of land legislation and so on. And the Commission is obviously going to be looking at various issues of reform into the future. So maybe if you could explain to me why the word reform has been dropped from the Land Commission's title.
I'll just make some comments and pass to Fiona. Essentially, the Commission is now going to also take account of what came out of the agricultural holdings, so it will now also include a tenant farmer commissioner. And so the view was that a Scottish Land Commission was actually a broader title than a Land Reform Commission and would encompass the work of the Tenant Farmer Commissioner. Fiona. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, at the point of public consultation, which was December 2014, we did consult on the notion of having a Scottish Land Reform Commission, and that was what it was named in the consultation document. We then had, in January 2014, the report of the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group, which did recommend the establishment of the Tenant Farming Commissioner as well. So given that it is current Scottish Government policy to minimise the establishment of public bodies as far as possible, and also that the establishment of both offices would be to similar timescales, the decision was taken by ministers to put the two together so that they could share staff and resources and make efficiencies that way, but still have their own remits. And it is considered that the title that the body now has, the Scottish Land Commission, is more suitable given the broader remit.
Well, I'm glad you're confident that the parts of the bill dealing with agricultural holdings are going to solve the problems of agricultural holdings way into the future. I've got my doubts myself. I'm sure lots of other issues will arise, so there will still be the need for reform even in relation to ag holdings as we move on, because that, you know, for obvious reasons. So, and I think the word reform has a significance, I think, within with the general public. You know, it indicates a willingness of the government to actually continue to look for reform, because there's lots to do in general land reform terms, and also, as I say, in relation to ag holdings. So it is something I think that I would maybe ask that you think about again, because it gives a really good, powerful political message about where the government wants to go in the future.
Absolutely. Happy to take anything away and consider it.
Okay. Thank you very much for that.
Can I just add that absolutely, the Scottish Government's position is exactly that this is part of a journey and there's a lot of work still to be done. There's a lot going on in this ambitious bill, but there will be more to come. So I think the point is around whether or not the title of the bill, the title of the Commission does what I think we all agree needs to be done.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Just another point about the Commission itself and its membership. I noticed that in the bill, the Commission has to appoint people who have experience or expertise in a range of issues, land reform, law, finance, etc. And I just wonder if that's sufficiently wide, or if any consideration was given to other more specific areas such as forestry, land management, and there will be other areas as well. That, maybe on the face of it, looks relatively restrictive. Could you maybe comment on that?
Certainly, yes. The members of the Commission, as you said, will need a broad range of expertise, and the bill does require Scottish ministers to have regards to the desirability for the Commission having expertise in land reform, law, finance, economic issues, planning, development and environmental issues. This is a non-exhaustive list, and we consider that the ones we have listed there do cover all areas and other sectors. We do consider that these are of the most relevance for the five land commissioners in taking forward the programme of work and considering the impact of law and policy in relation to land in Scotland. And, of course, the Commission will have a budget to procure advice and research externally and will be able to, you know, draw on other expertise anyway. It also has the ability to establish committees and that sort of thing, so it will be able to draw on other expertise. And we did give consideration to extending the list, but where do you draw the line in terms of listing different sectors? So that's why we have kept it narrow, but we will, of course, or ministers will, of course, always be taking into account different sectors, mm-hmm, and how they are represented within those categories.
Yeah, thanks for that. I understand the reasoning, but what would concern me a little bit is that with a list like that, there are people with other skills and experience and expertise who might feel, I don't fit into that category, so I'm not going to put myself forward. You know, it might actually restrict the pool of people who are available. So again, I think it's just something we need to, and the government needs to think a little bit more about as we move on.
Mentories, before you come back, yeah. Alec Ferguson and Graham Day.
Yeah, just very briefly, one of the criticisms, if that's the right word, or one of the concerns that's been raised through a lot of people who've come back to us in written evidence, is that there appears to be no cross-referencing with this bill to things like the land use strategy. Mm. And I just wonder whether it is envisaged that part of the Commission's work would be to cross-reference the work it's doing with other rural areas of policy like the land use strategy.
It will ultimately be for the land commissioners themselves to establish their own programme of work and what they do wish to take forward. But I don't know, Kate, do you want to add to that in terms of crossover other government policy areas?
Certainly the intention for the land commissioners is that the land commissioners will be free to look at any area of policy in relation to land in Scotland. So they will be free to look at particular areas or to look at the links and the joins between disparate areas relating to land in Scotland. But as Fiona stated, it would be for the land commissioners to decide how to take that on. Scottish ministers could ask them to have a look at it, but ultimately it will be for the land commissioners to decide. Certainly the intention that in developing the land rights and responsibilities statement, that careful consideration would be given to how that statement and the objectives for land reform fit within the wider areas that are relevant to land, including development, land use, biodiversity, climate change, across any matter relating to land in Scotland. And it's hoped that through the process of developing that statement, we would be able to consult and develop a good, clear explanation of how these fit together. But it has been quite a central consideration looking at the links of this as the bill has been developed.
So just to clarify, are you saying that it is envisaged that the statement, when it's finalised, will specifically refer to land use strategy and other policy areas?
Certainly in developing the statement, we'll be looking closely at the links between those. I couldn't say at this point in time, preempting the consultation process, that will need to be engaged exactly what the end product will be, but it would be part of the considerations. And that was a message that came through strongly in the responses to the consultation paper, so it's certainly something we would be taking on board.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I noted the response to Dave Thompson's earlier point, but can I just say, given the important part that forestry has in terms of land use and the fact that we have specific tree planting targets, very important tree planting targets, surely we would want to specifically note the importance of access to expertise in forestry?
There are a number of areas across the issues relating to land reform where it will, in certain circumstances, be very important to get that expert advice. Again, Scottish ministers had taken the decision in terms of the drafting at this stage that those areas listed provided that overarching, and that where those specific and relevant expertise were needed, that there would be the possibility to access them when they were required. Again, we're happy to take back any particular recommendations that come from the committee and stakeholders, and I'm sure Scottish ministers will be happy to consider that further.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Mike Russell.
I just press the point that Alex Ferguson made, because I think it's very important. 23A1. In exercising their functions, the Land Commissioners must have regard to the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement prepared under Section 1. So it would seem to me inconceivable that the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement did not, firstly, take into account land usage and all issues. It's a high-level statement about all issues in land. And secondly, inconceivable that the Land Commissioners would then not have an involvement in considering that. So, whilst accepting the freedom of the Commissioners to set their own work programme, under the legislation, the issue of land usage, all the land policy that the government sets, must, by this piece of legislation, surely, mean that the Land Commissioners will be taking those forward. That's not a misunderstanding.
That's correct.
Okay, good. Absolutely. That's important. Thank you.
Dave, final point.
Thanks, Convener. Just one final issue for me, and that's the Commission's strategic plan. The bill as it stands just now says that the Minister has to sign that off, but there's no provision in there for wider consultation. So I just wonder if you can give us some indication of how that wider consultation, which I think would be essential, will actually be achieved.
We haven't legislated specifically for consultation within the bill, because it's very much our view that it will be for the Land Commissioners to decide how they take forward their programme of work, but that we fully anticipate that they will be open to consultation within their approach, and that they will naturally, in devising their programme for work and their strategic plan, be consulting with stakeholders. So we don't consider we need to expressly say that on the face of the bill.
You don't feel that there should be a duty to consult widely? Because if that's not in there, there's nothing to stop them just producing their plan from within a very restricted pool of people and organisations and popping it over to the minister. If there was a duty to consult widely on this, which would be a very simple thing to insert into the bill, then at least we would be sure that they would do that, because they could decide not to do it as commissioners, I suppose.
Well, indeed they could, but however, in order for that, for the reports and the recommendations to be seen as credible, ultimately, you know, naturally good stakeholder engagement makes that product credible, and something that Scottish ministers and indeed Scottish Parliament would wish to take forward. So, you know, as Scottish Government is very open to consultation, we do consider that that is very much the direction of travel for the Land Commissioners and what they will want to do in taking forward their work.
Times change, views change, political parties change, governments change. You know, 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line, if there's no requirement, you might have a government and a commission who don't really want to consult. So would it not be just that little bit stronger if there was a duty for them to do it?
We'll give some consideration to that.
Okay, thank you. Looking at transparency of land ownership in Scotland now, Sarah Boyack is going to lead off on this one. I suspect there may be a few others.
Thank you very much, Convener, and welcome to the panel this morning. I'd like to ask my questions in two categories. Firstly, about the background underpinning the drafting of Part 3 on the transparency of land ownership in Scotland. And I want to tease out some of the questions that have been made in the submissions to us about the background of the definitions used on the face of the bill and letting us understand some of the choices in the final crafting of the bill. So first, just a very technical question about whether the definition of land includes buildings. If the principle is that there should be greater transparency about land ownership, why should knowledge of who owns land be restricted? And I'm particularly interested in the logic behind the background to the decision to make it not to make it incompetent for non-EU registered entities to register title in Scotland. Reading through the justification, it seems to be suggested that because trust could own land, it would hinder traceability and accountability. But surely if there were EU registered companies, that would enable transparency and it would enable a paper trail. And leading on from that, it's a matter of does the Scottish Government recognise the suggestion that 750,000 acres of land held in Scotland are in tax havens? So very keen to just explore some of the technicalities around the choices made. And it feels like it cuts across the ambition to be able to map ownership that everybody has signed up to. So it feels like quite a big loophole. So quite interested in the technical reasoning behind this. And that was my first set of questions, Convener.
First set of questions, right. Okay, let's take it bit by bit. Who's going to start?
What I'd like to do is just to take those one by one, if that's okay. So if we can start with the question
helpful.
Of the
yes.
definition of land and whether or not that includes buildings.
Yes, it does. Yes, it would include the buildings on the land.
So the second question was a matter of whether or not the Scottish Government consider it to be in the public interest that people should have knowledge about who owns land, and I'm going to pass to Matt to just give some of the background on that.
Okay. Good morning, committee. Obviously, one of the things the Scottish Government are bringing forward in conjunction with the Registers of Scotland is the commitment to complete the land register within 12 years, and 10 years. That's a big job, and it's something that the Registers of Scotland are now taking forward. So that's a commitment to increase the traceability of land and to ensure that all legal owners are represented in the land register and all the land of Scotland is mapped within the land register. That's a big step in increasing the traceability of land ownership in Scotland, because some land just now is currently recorded in the Register of Seasons and which can be difficult to interpret and may need some certain legal knowledge, and the land register is a lot more it's a lot more modern, it's map based, it's easy to interpret. The Registers of Scotland are also leading on a task force on a new land information system for Scotland. And the idea is to have a Scottish land information system, which would be sort of electronically available. And again, that would again increase the accessibility to information about land ownership in Scotland. And rather than having to go through the Register of Scotland, they would be able to be carried out online. So that again, is a part of a general picture of increasing land ownership. You've made reference to the EU entities proposal that was in the consultation and was made by the Land Reform Review Group. The Scottish Government recognise that there is a desire for greater transparency, greater accountability and traceability of landowners in Scotland. When we looked further into this proposal after the consultation, it became apparent that it wouldn't necessarily give the traceability and accountability that they were necessarily desired. You mentioned trusts, and yes, you know, trusts could be used to obscure land. There's also it wouldn't deal with sort of the complex corporate structures that can be used to hide the ownership of land or to obscure the ownership of land, and other such things, such as other areas as well. So, on a whole, we didn't think that it would actually provide what was actually the policy objective, which would increase traceability. So we're section 35 and section 36 will allow regulation making powers, and we feel that they will, will provide that traceability when it is required.
Yeah, I still don't really get the sense of why it wouldn't be legitimate to ask those questions. We totally get that corporations or corporate structures exist, but there is an issue about being transparent about the ownership of land. I haven't, and you said there were other areas as well that had led you down that path. So I think I'd be quite interested in knowing what they were, if it was possible to provide supplementary information on that, if you don't have it at your fingertips just now.
We'd be more than happy to provide further information to you.
And there was a question about the... do you recognise the statistic that 750,000 acres of land in Scotland are held in tax havens?
I don't know if that figure is correct or not, and I'm not sure it could actually be established, but it's something we could take away and look into. I don't know the answer to that.
That's great, because it kind of goes to the heart of accountability and transparency. The second question I had was about practically how people might actually use Section 35 and exploring the role of the keeper. And I suppose it comes down to the principle of transparency as an objective. You've rightly mentioned the land registration process over the next decade. And if we agree that it's a good thing to have transparency, as suggested by the Scottish Government, why should knowledge of who owns land only be released if a reason for a request meets certain criteria? One of the representations we've received is that requests should be limited to legitimate and reasonable grounds. And I'm wondering what the Scottish Government's view on this would be. What would be the grounds? How will be that specified? And what will be the role of the keeper in determining whether anyone should be able to find out that information? Should you have to be a citizen with particular interests, or could any citizen in Scotland ask that question?
The regulations that were made under 35, I think maybe clarify that the request authority that's referred to within section 35 has not yet, there's no decision being made on who that will be, and that will be one thing that would be made and set out in the regulations when they're made. Section 35 would be open. If somebody wanted to make a request for information, it's really where someone is having issues connected with an area of land. That could be an individual, it could be a community, it could be a company, it could be somebody. There's something happening on an area of land. It could be, say, the way the land is being managed, it's causing in flooding, or maybe issues with access, or even a simple issue that somebody's not maintaining the fences on a farm properly, or an area of ground which is letting stock trespass onto other land. So it's really where there's the management or the use or of an area of land is having some sort of issue on seeing a neighbour, and the person's trying to has tried to have these issues addressed. They've gone through the land register or the register of seizings to trace the legal owner. The legal owner, in a way, is not responding to their issues, or it may be a partner actually. It is a company that's an offshore tax haven or such like, and there may be a person that sits behind that company or that trust that's actually the person that's got maybe the decision-making power over the land and how that land is being managed, and actually the issue that is causing the harm to the individual. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, so just to clarify, so just a general in-principle knowledge of who owns land, just somebody wanting to know who owns land or to monitor the different categories of who owns land in Scotland, that wouldn't be covered by this bill automatically?
Section 36, which includes the power for the keeper to request information, and that would include the keeper to request information about the categories. So section 36, 35, you know, quite separate sections, and 36 would allow you to provide the category of land, you know, and that's information that could be then added on to the register. And section 36 also allows, when an application registration has been made, to provide further information about persons that they may have control over the proprietor. So there's a mixture of balance, but 35 in particular is where there's a particular issue in hand that really needs to be addressed.
I'm just going to ask Kate to add a comment.
Just wonder if I know clarification. I think in this debate, this is a very complex issue, and obviously in talking about it, people can sometimes mean different things by information about who owns land in Scotland. And it's just to clarify that Scottish ministers are completely committed to there being a complete register of all legal ownership of land in Scotland. So we're not saying for a second that it's not in the public interest for people to know who the legal owners of land are in Scotland. You can already access that information through a request to the Keeper of the Registers of Scotland. The information is available from the Land Register or from the General Register of Seizings. Through completion of the Land Register, knowledge about legal ownership will be much clearer and much more easily accessible. But legal ownership will be fully publicly available, and that is at the moment, and the intention is to improve that and make access to that better. What we're talking about in terms of the EU legal entities in Section 35 and Section 36 is talking about what information should be available to a public above and beyond the legal ownership. And in that case, it's about looking at the information we're talking about, whether that's some kind of controlling or beneficial interest over land or details about the legal proprietor above and beyond what they would be required to disclose in order to register their land. And you have to look carefully at what that information would be used for, why you need it, and what the most appropriate and balanced way of gaining access to that information is, while considering the interests of all the parties involved. And what we have done is put forward provisions in this bill, which together with the completion of the Land Register and the Information Property Service, we believe are the best balance to get the information that is necessary without having an unjustified interference on the interests of landowners and others.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay,
your colleagues might want to come in and ask other questions.
Well, we do indeed. I just have to ask you, first of all, what account have you taken of the discussions about the fourth money laundering directive that's been passed, about the moves in London to have a bill that will expose who company owners actually are, and whether, in fact, that ambition is met by the terms in which you've described access to information? Because it seems to me that knowing who owns the land has actually got to get back to the beneficial owners. It's got to get to there to know who actually owns the land. And it doesn't seem to me that the way in which this has been written is actually getting us to that point. And in your process of constructing the bill in its present form, have you taken that into account? People want to know who the beneficial owners of land are. I don't believe in the answer you've given us that you've told us.
We have fully taken into consideration the EU and EU context in this regard. The Fourth Money Laundering Directive and the Small Business Enterprise and Employment Act obviously look at issues of money laundering and tax evasion, and for those reasons, both the EU and the UK have decided that there are very strong reasons for requiring the disclosure of what is referred to as controlling interests in the Act, and what's often referred to as beneficial interests in the Money Laundering Directive, and we have taken full consideration of those issues. What Scottish ministers need to consider in the context of land reform in Scotland is the basis and rationale for which that information is necessary in order to further land reform in Scotland. And those are the considerations that we have taken. The Small Business Enterprise and Employment Act will in some circumstances potentially help increase transparency of land ownership in Scotland, in that if land is held by a UK company, then that information may be available. It's not quite so straightforward with the EU's Fourth Money Laundering Directive, because although that information is required to be held under the directive, it depends on the implementation in the specific countries, because there's no requirement in the directive, as I understand it, for that information to be made public.
Indeed, I make the point that the Scottish Affairs Committee in London identified the fact that if trusts were to be exposed, that it would take a fundamental change in UK law. That's their own words. So when Sarah Boyack points out that there are probably 750,000 acres of land in Scotland held in tax havens, you haven't answered our question about whether that has been taken into account in the drafting of the bill.
The issue of whether there is land that may potentially be held in offshore taxes has, of course, been taken into consideration. And again, we have developed the proposals that we think are balanced and appropriate in the circumstances. But I'm, again, happy to take away all the comments of the committee, and obviously Scottish ministers will be happy to consider those further.
Do you recognise the 750,000 acres estimate in trust?
That would not be possible to answer that question without referring to the Registers of Scotland who hold the records. As my colleague Matt had mentioned, I think it would possibly be difficult to clarify that from the information that is currently held, but I couldn't answer that question without referring to colleagues in the registers. But again, we'll take that away and come back to the committee in writing on that issue.
Mike Russell?
I do feel that very heavy weather is being made of this. I think it's absolutely clear from the representations that the committee has received. It's absolutely clear from the debate upon this that the majority of people in Scotland thought that the original proposal in the consultation was the right proposal. And that was that there should be a democratic duty for the disclosure of information, and that it was undesirable for information for land to be held outside the European Union in trust. So I think that is clear. To that extent, little has changed in Scotland since the 19th century. The people are mightier than a lord. The slogan of the Highland Land League still applies. And this is a touchstone, I think, of land reform. It seems to me that is where we're going to end up. So I do think it is very important that as the drafting continues for amendment, that is considered by the government. Because the knowledge of who owns land is vital, not just for individuals who are affected by a fence or a piece of plantation. It's vital for a community, and it's vital for a country. And I think that needs to be recognised as billed. Now, I think that principle was accepted in the consultation. I think it needs to be thought about again. And if there are issues, for example, that the position that the UK government might take, the Advocate General might take, well, the people are mightier than the Lord. And I think that should be remembered.
It's very appropriate that you take forward engaging communities in decisions relating to land question next, Mr. Russell, because it applies directly to this.
Yes, I do think this section 4, which has been a little neglected in discussion of the bill, is quite central to what the bill is about. Because if consultation is what should take place, and I think all of us accept, and I think I have to say, may I praise the policy memorandum, I think that there was some very sensible information in there about exactly what this was about, then consultation is about more than telling. And what the actual words of the bill are is really just about telling. This is what the landowner is going to do, and the community has therefore been told. Now, I could take you to communities within my own constituency where consultation is about telling, where decisions about what happened on people go and have a public meeting and saying, this is what we're going to do. So I think in this section, it is quite important that we understand what the policy intention is and how it will be implemented. Now, the three paragraphs that are in this, the four paragraphs, 1, 2, 3, and 4, are added to by the policy memorandum. Can you perhaps just address what is in the rest of this in terms of what the consequences would be if those who own land do not consult? how that would affect them, both for charities, and it's clear in terms of Oscar, but more importantly for private landowners. And the final point, which isn't addressed in the bill, and I just think we need to think about this, how does this apply to people who want to own land? You know, I could take you to somewhere where somebody has bought 12.7 square miles within the last 3 years without any consultation about what they are going to do with that land. They have made the decision of what they are going to do with that land. That seems to me contrary to the spirit of the bill. So how can this operate in terms of existing landlords, and particularly how can it operate in terms of people who might intend to be landlords?
I'll maybe take those three issues in turn. First of all, the Scottish Minister's intention is that the guidance under Section 37 would be about engaging communities, and engagement goes a lot further than consultation. Consultation is one form of engagement. Although drafted for very different reasons, if you look at the National Standards for Community Engagement, which is obviously set out for the public sector but can be adapted, provides a useful model that clearly explains that engagement is very dependent on the circumstances, and it depends on the case and the issue at point, but there's a whole range of what will be considered engagement and what will be considered appropriate depending on the circumstances, ranging from if you're required to do something under environmental legislation and you don't have a choice in the matter, then the appropriate level of engagement would be perhaps to inform communities of what was being done and why it was being done. If there was a range of options for taking forward that, then you would potentially be consulting in that you would be going out and saying this needs to be done, but here are the options, what are your views, and those would be taken into consideration, all the way down to co-production, which would be we want to achieve a certain outcome, or we think we want to achieve a certain outcome, is this the outcome you agree with, and how can you work with us in order to design the best way of doing that. So what the guidance will intend to do is to set out clearly what is meant by engagement and set out those broad parameters while stressing that what is appropriate in the circumstances will be very much dependent on those circumstances, but it's certainly not just about consultation. It will be the broad full range of what is meant by engagement, and as we go through the process, we'll hopefully be using the national standards as a helpful guide to kind of translate engagement into the more specific context of landowners and communities. On the issue of where landowners, despite the guidance, would not wish to or do not engage with communities, I would first of all stress that there is now recognition amongst many landowners that there are considerable benefits from working with their local communities, and there are already many productive partnerships springing up around Scotland, and we know organisations such as Scotland Land and Estates are very supportive of this proposal and would be keen to work with us and landowners that they represent in taking this forward. The intention would be that Scottish ministers would work closely with stakeholders across public, private, third and community sectors to develop and promote the guidance to make sure that there was collective buy-in and that there was good promotion of the importance of engagement as the guidance is developed. Where landowners, despite the guidance, do not engage with communities on land-based decisions, then this can result in poorer outcomes for both landowners and communities and poorer relationships, and the disadvantages of this will also be made clear. For all landowners, including private landowners, a lack of consideration of the guidance and lack of engagement could be a factor that Scottish ministers would consider as part of the evidence provided by a community body to support an application for the right to buy land to further sustainable development, as it may assist in evidencing why the transfer of land to the community body or nominated third party is the only way of achieving the desired benefit to the community. And this would obviously be a factor taken into consideration. Scottish ministers are also exploring the ways in which a failure to engage with communities on land-based decisions might be taken into account in future decisions on the award of discretionary grants in relation to land. As you've noted, the case for charities is slightly different, as Oscars currently have powers under the 2005 Act, and where a charity trustee did not comply with the terms of the guidance issued by Scottish ministers, Oscar would be able to consider whether a charity trustee has complied with their duties under the 2005 Act, and if not, whether action may be taken for misconduct. So there are a range of ways in which failure to consider or comply with the guidance would be taken into consideration.
It's very important. There's Hugh Dignon sitting behind you. If I get embarrassed by having struggled with this on issues of wildlife crime, cross-compliance is extremely important in terms of ensuring that landowners are not rewarded if they are not prepared to operate in a sensible manner. Sorry, I interrupted.
Certainly that's one of the things that would be carefully considered as the guidance is developed. The third point you'd raised was whether this would apply to existing landowners, what would be the impact on future landowners? And I would say that once the guidance is developed and in place, then it would be very clear what was expected of landowners in Scotland, and that anybody considering purchasing land in Scotland would, if they have good agents, would be made aware of the fact that this guidance existed and what would be expected. And it is certainly hoped that that would factor into any person's considerations of where they to purchase land, that they would have to engage with and consider the needs of the communities in deciding how to.
If cross compliance becomes an issue, then it should at least be considered, and perhaps you would be good enough to think about this in drafting terms, it should at least be considered that it is an element within the conditions for people purchasing land. That, in other words, they would not have access to grants, one sort or another, forestry grants, or SRDP, any other grants, without adhering to a code.
Mike Ferguson and then Graham Day.
Just very briefly, Convener, and thank you. I know there is concern in the farming community, because I've had it raised in my own constituency, that this might impact on everyday farm management decisions. Can you comment on whether or not that will be the case?
I would hope that the guidance would very clearly state what was expected in terms of engagement and what proportionate and reasonable levels of engagement would be in day-to-day circumstances. If the day-to-day decisions of farmers were having a significant impact on the communities around them, then I would imagine there would be an expectation that they would discuss that with communities. It certainly isn't a mandate for communities to tell farmers what to do. It is very much about just considering the impacts, consulting with and considering the responses from the communities where decisions are likely to impact those communities.
Well, I'll leave it at that, but I'm sure we'll come back to that later. Thank you.
Graham D.
Thank you, Commissioner. Just perhaps a difficult question to answer, but when will the guidance, even in initial draft form, be available for the committee to see or the stakeholders to see? I'm concerned that if we don't see that during the process of scrutiny, or rather it comes towards the end or after the scrutiny process, I'm not sure that's entirely appropriate, because this is a hugely important bill, and I don't think it's enough to say, oh, that'll be taken care of guidance, if people aren't going to get at least a feel for what the guidance is going to suggest as we go through the process.
Mm-hmm. Scottish Minister's intention at this point would be to develop and draft the guidance in consultation with stakeholders, and to try and take as co-productive an approach as possible to developing this guidance. And if that was to be done, the process would likely commence after the bill has been taken through. But I can take away the committee's concerns.
I accept the huge logistical challenge that lies behind this, but I do think we need more meat on the bones in terms of what mm-hmm. the guidance might provide for.
Yeah, we had to try to set out a bit further information in the policy memorandum around that. And again, I wouldn't want to preempt the process of kind of consultation and producing the guidance in consultation with all the stakeholders who have an interest. But I'm sure the Scottish Minister would be content to consider what further information could be provided to the committee at this stage.
Well, we can explore that with the Minister's convener. Thank you.
Well, thank you. We'll try and move on now to the right to buy land to further sustainable development. Claudia Beamish is going to lead on this one.
Right. Thank you, convener, and good morning to everybody. Convener, with your forbearance, I'd simply like to ask for a point of clarification if the committee could have something in writing in relation to question 4 and the non-EU registered entities, and the extent to which that partiality fed into the final decision as to whether that would be something that would be on the face of the bill. It would be helpful if you could furnish that information to the committee, please.
Yes. Partiality, sorry, I didn't...
Well, I understood that if there was any value in this part of this going forward to the bill, that it would only be partial. Correct me if I'm wrong, but that's what I'd understood to be the case. And I'd like to see, through the committee, with the agreement of the committee, that the evidence that shows us that this isn't something that is appropriate for Scottish Government to take forward within the bill. If I've misunderstood it, I apologise.
Okay. What we can do is send the committee our analysis of the specific proposal around the EU ownership or an exclusion to explain the thinking that we went through and the evidence that we have.
That would be helpful. Thank you.
Can we move on to...
Thank you very much.
Question in hand.
And could I ask, in relation to sustainable development and also to the community right to buy issue more generally, if you could explain why was it considered that an additional community right to buy procedure was necessary in addition to those already in place? And that's a neutral question. And how all the various right to buy mechanisms will relate to each other. And I see that there's an issue around a third party possibility of right to buy as well, which is obviously a new suggestion. So if there could be comment on that, and possibly if not all today, you might be able to put that in writing to the committee.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm happy to answer that question. There are, of course, a number of crucial distinctions between the existing community rights to buy and that in this proposed bill. Part 5 is a right to buy even where there is an unwilling seller, unlike the preemptive community right to buy in Part 2 of the Land Reform Scotland Act 2003, but similar to the Part 3 crofting right to buy and the new Part 3A, which is the right to buy abandoned, neglected or detrimental land. The key test in the new Part 3A in the Community Empowerment, introduced in the Community Empowerment Act, is whether the land is abandoned, neglected, or the use or management of the land is causing harm to environmental well-being of the community. So the key test is about the condition and use of the land rather than the needs of the community. There were strong messages during the passage of the Community Empowerment Bill that, although much welcomed, there may still be circumstances where communities required access to land in order to meet their needs, but this would not be covered by the existing rights to buy or Part 3A. Therefore, the key tests for the right to buy to further sustainable development in land in Part 5 focus on the outcomes for the community rather than the condition of the land. As you'd mentioned, there are some specific differences, such as in Part 5, the right to buy land to further sustainable development, the community can nominate a third-party purchaser who would be, for example, a housing association or a local business partner to buy the land and so help deliver the benefits to the community. And the benefit of this arrangement is that the third parties may have access to resources and skills that would be unavailable to the community otherwise. Of course, Scottish ministers, in considering the application, will have to be satisfied that the test for consenting to the application would still be met in full, and they may therefore expect community and third-party partners to agree legal arrangements, for example, setting out delivery timescales, rights, liabilities, maintenance, etc. But it is viewed as this is a significant benefit to the Part 5 proposals.
Right, thank you.
I just add, though, that the process is very similar to the existing rights to buy, so in that sense they fit together, and we're not sort of expecting community bodies to have to deal with different procedures and processes for different rights to buy.
Right, well, that's reassuring in that the need for communities to have simplicity in moving forward is exceptionally important if this bill is going to become an act which is going to work. And that's just a personal view. I've got three other questions within the context of sustainable development. And obviously, that term is fundamental to the working of the bill. I know this is a very knotty problem from previous experience of other bills. What definition will the Scottish Government be using of sustainable development for this purpose? And I ask this because I really would like to understand this in terms of how the bill is going to work in view of the points that have been made previously about a regulation and secondary legislation. Why is it not on the face of the bill?
The reason it's not on the face of the bill is that Scottish ministers do not consider it necessary to define sustainable development, as its meaning is generally well understood and widely used in legislation. It's quite acceptable, certainly from Scottish ministers' point of view, in drafting terms to leave sustainable development as undefined, and there's examples in other legislation, such as Section 3E of the Town and Country Planning Act and in the other rights to buy, such as in Section 97H1B2 of the 2003 Act. By not providing a specific definition, sustainable development is left deliberately broad, and Scottish ministers and, where necessary, courts will be able to determine what sustainable development means in a particular case, as they have in relation to other legislation. And there's a helpful quote, which is not too long, from Park, if you wouldn't mind me just referring to it, where the Lord President says, in my view, the expression sustainable development is in common parlance in matters relating to the use and development of land. This is an expression that would be readily understood by the legislators, the ministers and the Land Court. An explanation of what is in general meant by sustainable development is set out in the policy memorandum accompanying the bill on page 26. And again, I'll just refer to what's said, that sustainable development is defined as development that is planned with appropriate regard for its longer-term consequences and is geared towards assisting social and economic advancement that can lead to further opportunities and a higher quality of life for people whilst protecting the environment. Sustainable development requires an integrated approach to social, economic and environmental outcomes. Sustainable communities are more self-reliant, with increasing economic independence and a better quality of life, while conserving or enhancing their environment, contrasted with unsustainable communities where populations are declining, local economic and social activities inhibited, and the natural heritage is damaged.
Right, thank you.
If you wouldn't mind if I could just add that sustainable development is only one of the key tests that have to be met.
Yes.
So it has to be, the others are set out in section 47.2, so not to look at it in isolation.
Thank you for that. I understand the arguments you're putting forward, but there is a tension, I think, having looked at this issue more than I would even choose to have done in the past, that there's a tension between needing a broad definition so it can be taken forward in a way which is inclusive, but also having a definition which is not risking legal challenge. And I do have a concern about the whole issue of the fact that, to be frank, that I think the Scottish Government has shied away from using this term in the past in some instances, in some acts, and having gone through the Aquaculture Bill and having gone through the other bills, there has definitely been a sense, in my judgment, that it is difficult to define. So I do have concerns about it being left open, and I understand that it's in the policy memorandum, and thank you for reading what you've read, but I want to highlight that because I think it still needs a considerable amount of thought. And could I also ask you, when considering how the significant benefit or significant harm are to be interpreted, how will consideration be given to the impact on the landowner? Is this compliant with Article 1, Protocol 1 of the ECHR, as asserted in the policy memorandum, which is at paragraph 201.
Yeah, thank you. As my colleague Rachel mentioned, the tests for ministers to decide upon an application are set in 47, and there's a number of different limbs to what are termed the sustainable development conditions under that test. The limbs specifically concern significant benefit or significant harm to the community, and the test is specifically about the significant harm and significant benefit to the community. And in interpreting what that would be, there's some further kind of aid issues that ministers need to take into consideration that are set out under 47.10. However, in terms of the consideration of the impacts, benefits and on landowners, first of all, just to say that in developing the provisions, the Scottish ministers have, of course, been careful to consider the rights and interests of all persons who may be affected, in order to develop balanced and fair tests and process. And Scottish ministers believe this is what's set out in Part 5. Landowners' rights and the potential benefits and harms to the landowner will be considered and protected in a number of ways throughout the right to buy process, including requirements for the community body to have written to the landowner to ask them to transfer the land at least 6 months prior to the application to give fair notice and encourage cooperation and engagement before entering into the process. Landowners have the right to make representations and will be invited to make representations at various points in the process to clearly explain rationales and reasonings and potential impacts on those landowners to Scottish ministers. As we've already discussed, there are strict tests that have to be met before Scottish ministers consent to the application, including whether consenting to the application is in the public interest, which would require detailed consideration of the impact on all the persons affected by the transfer, including the landowner. If the application is consented to by Scottish ministers, then the landowner would receive market value for the land. In certain circumstances, the landowners can potentially claim for losses and costs associated with the transfer. And landowners also have a right of appeal against both the Scottish minister's decision and the valuation. In addition, the principle of encouraging collaboration runs right through the right to buy, and to aid this provision is made for mediation between communities, landowners and other parties in relation to the proposed exercise of the right to buy. Finally, in making a decision on an application for a right to buy, ministers will have to ensure that their decision is compatible with Article 1, Protocol 1 of the European Convention on Human Rights. And part of this test will require ministers to be satisfied that on a fair balance, the benefits that will result from the transfer of land outweigh the interference with the landowner's Article 1, Protocol 1 rights.
Right. I think that's important to have that clarification in view of the principles of the bill and wanting to take forward, where appropriate, more community ownership of land in Scotland. So I think it's important to understand that.
Just before you go on to the next bit, there's a couple of supplements on this one, please. Alec Ferguson, you were wanting one, I think.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I have to say I'm fairly stunned by the comment or the statement that you made that Scottish ministers don't think it's necessary to define sustainable development. I say that because there's already raised by the land managing fraternity, if I can call it that, a great deal of concern about this section of the bill. Because every time this has been raised previously, they have always been told by Scottish ministers that good landowners, good land managers, good farmers have nothing to fear. And I think this is going to give them something to fear, if I may say so. And I say that because I accept, yes, there are criteria under Section 47 that have to be satisfied if an application to buy is to go ahead. But not one of those refers to the impact on the land. Now, you can have the best farmer in the parish who makes his submissions and he makes his argument and he makes his impact. He makes all the case to retain the land that is being sought. And yet, if it fulfills those four criteria, the community seems to me, under a definition of sustainable development that has been deliberately left broad, in your own words, and I do not see how those two tie up to give any founding to the statement that good farmers have nothing to fear from this. This, to me, shifts the balance, particularly where you have a third party involvement, away from an equitable balance that should be predominant in this bill. And we will pursue that at other times, I'm sure, but I wish to lay that down on the record just now.
I would potentially just mention quickly in response that obviously one of the criteria is consideration of the public interest, and then considering the public interest, Scottish ministers would have to take broad consideration of a range of issues, such as the importance of the agricultural sector and agricultural industry and using agricultural land for those purposes in Scotland, so that such issues would be a broad part of the consideration in that test.
Yeah.
So the policy memorandum at 203 to 205 anticipates the possibility of these right, these local authorities being affected by these. Presumably, just for clarity, that means that where a community finds that a local authority ownership of land is impeding its ability to operate and is suffering significant harm, it could utilise this bill rather than a community empowerment bill? Am I right about that?
It is that local authority land isn't precluded from Part 5. I mean, we would expect, and obviously one of the things Scottish ministers will have to consider is the kind of guidance necessary to support communities' decisions on which particular route to go down. It is anticipated that the community empowerment public sector asset transfer provisions would be more appropriate. But yes, the part 5 ones may also apply.
But there may be circumstances, say, where a community body applies the right to buy land owned by a local authority on the provisions of Part 5. Those would be those circumstances in which the health of the community effectively is impaired by the ownership by the local authority. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. I want to raise a specific case that's been raised with me as by way of example that might clarify what we're talking about here. In terms of the community right to buy, if you have a situation where a farmer has a small field on which he grows crops on a regular basis, but the local community want that field for the establishment of a community woodland, under the terms of the bill, Is it feasible that the community would be able to acquire that line, that land?
I would just like to, just as a broad context, just remind the committee that what we're talking about here is in cases where there is significant harm, mm-hmm. which is likely to affect the community. So this isn't a broad and general right. It's in those quite specific instances.
Right. So the example I've given wouldn't happen.
It wouldn't be possible to comment even on a hypothetical, even with the detail you've provided. It really would be case by case. As Trudi pointed out, and as Rich was mentioned in the tests earlier, the community would have to put forward a strong application that showed the significant benefit that was going to be delivered, which identified the harm that would be caused to the community if this was not taken forward, and the Scottish ministers would have to consider strongly the impacts that would have on that farmer. I mean, if losing that field was going to have a significant impact on that farmer's business, then that's something that would have to weigh quite heavily in the consideration. Again, it would be about balancing the impacts on all parties and considering those and reaching the decision. So I couldn't really give it a yes or no.
But the answer you're giving really is, in principle, it could happen.
In principle, an application could be made on those basis. I couldn't state what the decision would likely be.
There is scope for that. Yes. Right. OK, thank you.
No, thank you for that debate. And there's a final point, I think, for this panel, Dana. I hope.
It's a brief one. Whether consideration was given to providing for a direct power of ministerial intervention to buy land to further sustainable development if there is no community present? Within the context of the four tests and
there was early consideration given to a wide range of powers to enforce changes in control over land, such as through enforced leasing. But the key consideration was to minimise government intervention to what was necessary to achieve the overall aims. And in this context, what was looked at in the bill was encouraging better engagement and having the possibility of transfer under Part 5 should no voluntary routes succeed. So the focus of the provisions in this bill are very much about the relationships between communities and landowners, and making sure that balance is right, and overcoming barriers that communities face in the circumstances that apply in Part 5. There has been, as part of this bill, no detailed consideration of the types of intervention powers that I know some stakeholders have talked about, where there are no existing communities. That's not something that has been considered as part of this bill, but obviously maybe something that would be considered in the wider land reform agenda.
Right, so it's not something that you would see as appropriate, or is it something, I'll phrase a question, sorry, is it something that you would see as appropriate to look at in view of the fact that for the future of our land in Scotland, it may well have a resonance with
certainly Scottish ministers are considering closely all the recommendations of the Land Reform Review Group and will consider all the evidence put to this Parliament, this committee, as part of stage one.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much to our witnesses for this part of the bill. We're going to change over very rapidly because we have to fit in a programme that allows us to finish before Parliament starts at 2 o'clock. So the next couple of teams are going to have to be very succinct in their answers, and so are the members in their questions, because we have a lot of an agenda to cover after the land reform as well. So if we can change over just now straight away, we'll have a break after this next group, but we must press on. So it's you that's on.
Next. Graham's first.
Graham's first.
To start, yeah. I've got my question sharpened up, so I'm going to try and rattle through them.
I know. We'll restart now. Thank you for the second panel's rapid turnaround. And adjoining Trudi Sharp, we've got Dougie McLaren, Brian Peddie, Hugh Dignon and Helen Jones. And I refer members to the questions and ask Graham Day to start the first of these for panel two.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I'm conscious of time. Can I ask why the bill seeks to remove the business rates exemption for shootings and not fishing, farming and forestry?
I'm going to ask Dougie to answer these questions.
Indeed, these are separate land occupations that all have separate exemptions in legislation. Fishing's ministers are looking at separately under the Wild Fisheries Review, and that process is ongoing separately. Some fishings are in the rule because if the District Salmon Fishery Board requests the assessor to make an entry, then an entry can be made, and that's used for the fisheries assessment levy, not rates. So they're not rateable. But like I say, that's been considered separately. Agriculture and forestry, clearly different land occupations from shooting and deer stalking. Ministers are content to continue the exemption. They think it's sustainable and in line with their policy priorities for agriculture and forestry. I mean, clearly, of all the sectors that the Scottish Government promotes, only a very few get targeted rating concessions. So ministers are obviously content that the agriculture and forestry ones are sustainable in line with their policies and have no plans to end them.
Okay. Can I ask, what analysis has been made of the impact that ending the current exemptions would have on rural jobs, rural businesses, and the potential knock-on effects, for example, in terms of school roles and the viability of rural schools, which are issues that have been raised with myself?
So we've used the information that we have. I mean, clearly, shootings in deer forests haven't been on the valuation rolls for the last 20 years because of the exemption. So we're missing a part of that evidence base. We don't know the quantification of the tax base. So if you don't know that, it's then very hard to go on to try to model impacts and implications of that. We know that from what UK Minister said 20 years ago, that there were around £2 million worth of rates revenue from sporting rates. So what we've done is we've projected that forward in line with the overall rates revenue in Scotland in the period to say this is what we estimate the future income to be, subject, of course, to rates relief. But there's only so much that we can do. I mean, clearly, we've had a lot of evidence and information from stakeholders, and where they've tried to sort of quantify the impacts, that's helpful. But until we know the valuation of the tax base from the assessors, then we cannot accurately start to model these impacts and implications. And even if we were to try to do so and put, for example, our own kind of predictions or estimates of what the tax base would be out there, that could be very problematic come the time the assessors start to do their own formal statutory valuation, you know, if the two figures differed, for example. So we've tried to sort of state the information we know and the basis that we've made the proposal on. But as I say, without the 20 years worth of valuations, only so much we can do.
Would you accept, however, there's the potential for there to be a negative impact from the move?
I think we recognise that taxes have impacts on taxpayers. I think that's just a generally accepted point that's definitely not lost on us. So what we try to do is kind of think through what that might look like. I mean, clearly the premise of valuation for rates is that the assessors try to hypothecate the rental value that a property would have, and then that valuation is then taxed by the poundage rate that Scottish ministers apply. So, you know, there's different elements to that.
Okay, I want to ask a series of questions if I may, Convener, which may allow a lead to colleagues coming in with supplementaries. It's been suggested to the committee that collecting the tax might be difficult. How would you respond to that assertion?
I'm not sure how it would be difficult. Local authorities have rating departments and statutory duties to levy and collect rates. They would make up their assessment rolls based on what the assessors put on the valuation rolls and then issue rates bills to these properties and enforce that as
okay,
normal.
But, sorry, I apologise. I've perhaps used the wrong word. It would be uneconomic to collect, given the logistics of collecting it set against what you may actually end up with?
There would be extra work for local authorities in collection. The cost of collection of all rates is estimated to be in the order of just over 6 million, I think, you know, for, you know, rates income of approaching 2.5 billion. So some might say that that's quite a low cost of collection. So we haven't had any direct evidence from local authorities as to what the incremental cost of this would be, but we consider it to be sustainable.
Okay. Can I ask how much net of any relief you estimate will be raised by this move? And can I also ask what would be the basis upon which relief is granted?
We don't know what the net revenue would be because it's obviously dependent on the valuations, as I said, and the spread of these valuations and how they're captured by the rating relief thresholds. So we just don't know. Hence, the best estimate we can give is around 4 million subject to rates relief.
But what will be the basis upon which the relief is granted in practice?
It will be the same eligibility criteria as for all prevailing rates relief for all rate payers. So, for example, small business bonus has criteria, you know, thresholds of rateable value under which different bands of properties get different rates of relief. So subject to continuing legislation, because the small business bonus scheme legislation currently expires at the end of this year and would need to be re-legislated for.
Flagged up yesterday would continue, of course.
Well, indeed, I mean, ministers have committed to continue and beyond if re-elected. So the kind of the prevailing rates relief will apply to shootings and deer forests in terms of eligibility in the same way that they do for other rateable properties.
Okay. Open up to colleagues.
Right. First of all, Alec Ferguson, then Mike Russell.
Thank you, Convener. Two very brief points. One is that if there is, as it seems to be accepted, a negative impact on rural employment, it's been put to us that this would also have a consequential negative impact on some aspects of conservation, more land management and that type of activity. Has any work been done to identify that? And my second question is, can you confirm that whether they're levied or not, rateable value will have to be applied to virtually every non-urban acre in Scotland in order to identify those that are going to have sporting rates levied on them?
Okay, on your first question, I mean clearly we have worked with colleagues across government to consider wildlife management issues and conservation issues. There's clearly a range of measures that the government takes to support wildlife management and conservation. I can maybe let Hugh expand in a minute. But so we consider the proposal for the tax very much in that context, and you know that informs us whether we think the tax is sustainable or not. It doesn't just because it has implications doesn't of course mean that we can't tax, because we tax many other things that the tax has implications for. So clearly that's quite a kind of a qualitative assessment that we make at the moment in the absence of quantitative valuations. Like we say, rates for shootings in deer forests were in place for over 100 years, so we know that, you know, broadly it worked, subject to, of course, you know, some criticism and issues that, from rate payers. So clearly we'll continue to work with rate players. There'll be a stage, as this goes through, subject to the passage of the bill, the assessors would then go on to produce and publish their draft valuations. And then, you know, after seeing that, the ministers will then, of course, take that into consideration when they set the poundage for 2017-18, which is when this is due to take effect. On your point about valuing every non-urban acre, what the assessors will, need to consider is, and well, certainly what they considered in the past, is that to identify shootings in deer forests was actually where there was shooting and deer stalking taking place. So they obviously go out and speak to the sector, and they'll speak to, as they see fit, to prospective rateable occupiers, and identify whether and what size of kind of volume of bag of culling is going on, and then they will, you know, correspondingly make entries on the roll. If there's what happened in the past is if there was nothing happening, they didn't get a zero entry in the roll. There was only entries in the roll where there was actually shooting and deer stalking was actually taking place. So if it's not taking place, it wasn't previously valued and rated. That's obviously for the assessors to interpret going forward. They've got statutory functions to do this. So, and you might want to seek their view as well.
Okay.
Sorry, I'm not sure if... Did you want to add anything about wildlife?
Well, I can leave that till...
Right, okay.
Yeah, I think...
Stakeholder meetings convened for the second time.
I think that's right. Yeah. Did you have anything to add to that at the moment, you dig then?
No, I don't think so. I mean, that'd be...
Okay, let's move on for some more questions. Mike Russell.
I have no objection to these proposals, except insofar that there needs to be some real care taken on the deer side. And I think the evidence in the folder from Jamie Fletcher points up quite well what the issues are. There is a quantitative and qualitative difference between deer forests and deer stalking as a sporting activity, and either the culling of deer for management purposes or the killing of deer to provide meat into a market which is pretty insatiable for wild venison at the present time. In those circumstances, there are elements of what takes place which are much more akin to wildlife management and proper deer management, and we should not penalise those because they're absolutely essential in parts of Scotland, and equally where there is a production of a meat for consumption, of which the stalking is simply the means by which the killing takes place. I think we have to be careful there. Now, those are complex issues. I know Hugh is particularly capable of dealing with complex issues, but they will need to be thought through carefully in terms, I believe, of amending this legislation so that we do not have unintended consequences in that one area. And I would ask that officials consider that as the bill goes forward. I'm sure perhaps you would like to say if that is already under consideration.
It absolutely is, because as you say, it's a complex issue, and much of what the assessors do is similarly complex. I mean, I suppose in this case, what they'll need to distinguish is if you're talking about what is at one end of the of a spectrum, sporting stalking, which is kind of, I suppose, for the sake of argument, undeniably sporting, and at the other end of the spectrum, you might have land management culling, which, for example, forest enterprise actually are paying either staff or contractors to undertake, so it's not like they're getting a rental income from it. Actually, the transaction is the other way. So,
one part of that is agricultural activity too, essentially.
Well,
the type of agricultural activity.
Well, perhaps. So this is what they assess, and then obviously on that spectrum there'll be some kind of greyer areas as well. So it'll be the job of the assessors to unpick that, and case law is quite helpful. So there's been kind of challenges
in the
past.
It's the job of the legislation to define that before the assessors unpick it. I mean, I'd be very concerned if we had legislation that required the assessors to interpret that usage. There has to be at least a definition of what the bill means to apply rates to. Because circumstances have changed since 1995.
They have. So shootings in deer forests have been statutory lands and heritages dating back to the 1854 Lands Valuation Scotland Act, and they haven't been defined. So in practice, they were interpreted from that time right through until this exemption in 1995. I think our initial thinking is that it would be problematic, perhaps, to try and define or redefine shootings in deer forests, perhaps in the face of the bill, because then that might lead to itself to interpretations or to avoidance behaviours. So we'll certainly...
Well, I want to enter a strong caveat to that. If the bill is to be drafted in such a way that, you know, we're just worried about avoidance behaviours, then it's not the type of bill we should be involved with. What I do believe we should be looking at is to make sure that those who are operating in a way which is justifiable under deer management and operating in a way in terms of deer as a resource, at least there is a way of understanding that. And I think certainly many of my constituents would be very worried if that was not defined. I don't know if Trudi wants to add to that in terms of the bill team and the bill thinking.
I think, other than to say that the points that Dougie was raising about distinguishing clearly between shoots and between culling and environmental and
the production
venison,
of meat.
We understand those are very different issues. We will definitely take note of what the committee said today and consider whether there's anything further that we think could be done either on the face of the bill or in other explanations to accompany it.
Okay,
I think we need to move to Sarah next. Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd just like to ask a brief supplementary about the issue of both the collection of these new rates and the spending of those rates as well. And just to explore a comment about the extent to which you have had discussions with local government colleagues and people in COSLA, given that there's the review of local government finance ongoing at the moment, this is obviously quite a significant change in terms of collection of new funds. And I note that in paragraph 103, it suggested that while local authorities will collect the money, that equivalent funding raised will be removed from the general revenue grant. So that poses the question about has that been discussed with local government colleagues internally and in COSLA, but also the issue about how the resource will be used, the extent to which you intend it to be ring-fenced resource, because in the same paragraph you talk about directing equivalent funding elsewhere within the Scottish Government's budget. And is that intended to support land management issues, deer management issues, action and wildlife crime? So it's just to get a clarification about how you intend to raise those resources through local government and the cost that they will incur in that process, but also how the money will be spent.
Okay. So as you said, local authorities will collect the rates, and local authorities keep all the rates that they collect. The way that the local government finance arrangements that are currently in place, that are negotiated and agreed with local government, is that their non-domestic rates income is budgeted for every year, and if they collect more than that, that's one of two parts of the components of the local government finance settlement, the other part being the general revenue grant. And if they collect more rates revenue than they were budgeted for, then the grant calculation comes down accordingly, so that they get the agreed total as part of their budget settlement. So that's the existing local government finance settlement.
I understand that, but this will be a new source of revenue.
Indeed.
So that we'll be able to predict this new money, but you're saying all of that money will go automatically to the Scottish Government?
Well, because of that arrangement, any additional revenue means less grant paid out from the Scottish budget, so that means that the Scottish budget benefits from the extra revenue, and hence the ministers have indicated that they would direct the extra revenue to the Scottish Land Fund.
Mm-hmm. And have you had the discussion?
Oh yeah, and we are engaging with local government. Yeah,
about the cost of collection.
So. Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Right, Jim Hume. Yes. Anything that's left of your question?
Absolutely.
Disregarding the marauders from your right.
No, that's not a problem at all. It's more important to get the answers out. I'm obviously concerned that, as it stands, assessors would be the ones that would be left to decide. Assessors are probably under quite a lot of pressure to get as much income in as possible for their local authorities. So I just wonder, and just want to make it quite clear, has there been any analysis at all regarding ending the exemption for deer management, on which is needed obviously for conservation and environmental reasons? We all know that we've had many sessions here where we've been concerned about too many deer in certain areas and the lack of the conservation and environmental culling that is needed. So has there been any evaluation at all on ending deer management exemptions and what impact that will have on conservation and the environment across Scotland?
So you're asking, has there been an assessment of the effect of ending the deer forest exemption for rates on deer management more widely?
On the exemption on deer management widely, forest or not?
Okay, so...
And that could go for other what you could call vermin species.
Yes, so we're proposing to end the deer forest exemption, and yes, there is a policy consideration in terms of wider deer management, and we are addressing that, we are considering that. I'm not sure if that's what you're asking, though.
Uh-huh. So there's not been an evaluation done yet. It's just being considered.
Well, like I said, we can only quantitatively use the figures that we have from past valuation and rating and to make our kind of projection. And until we sort of know more definitively what the assessor's valuations are going to be subject to the passage of the bill, we can't accurately model that.
I think you're more talking about funds coming in or not. I think we're more concerned about the environment and the fact if you're starting to tax culling of deer, for example, for environmental and conservation purposes, then perhaps there would be less cull and therefore more environmental damage.
Well, it may be useful if I was to add something here. I mean, clearly, you know, we're very well aware of the need to maintain the current cull levels, and indeed they will need to be sort of increased and intensified in some areas where there are particular focuses on deer damage. We are conscious that there is, on the face of it, an apparent potential for a conflict of interest between taxing of deer culling and the policy objective of improving sort of environmental protection. However, I think that there are two things I would say about that. First of all, this is the idea of deer being managed for purposes other than strictly sporting purposes, as Doug has already said, is something which is not new. It's not new for the assessors. And we don't think it's new in Scotland either. It may have changed in its balance and intensity over the recent years since the rates exemption has been in place. But it has, for example, forestry culling of deer has been in place for a long time and was in place certainly while the rates regime was in place before in 1995. So that's not a new issue, and we would expect that the assessors would have an understanding of that and an ability to take that into account in setting the appropriate level and valuations when they come to look at deer businesses. The other point I would want to make is that we think that the sort of incentives and management of deer management is probably better addressed through more focused and direct interventions, such as the use of SRDP money, the use of support through SNH for fencing initiatives, or money which is being provided. We've provided, for example, £100,000 per year over 2 years to help people develop habitat management plans and deer census work to better enable them to carry out the sort of deer management plans to protect the environment. So we would think that rather than try to use the tax system, which I think has some sort of universal applicability for specific environmental reasons, it's better to develop specific tools in the environmental field to achieve our objectives.
Okay, thanks, Henry.
I'll better move on to that just now. In that case, regarding deer management, why are interim measures included in the bill rather than either introducing measures now or waiting for the 2016 review to conclude before bringing forward a more comprehensive package of measures?
As you rightly say, Convener, the issue of the 2016 review is sort of crucial to this, really, and that, as you all know, is something which was agreed with yourself and the committee following your review of deer management in 2013-14. So we have a position where we have agreed with the yourselves and made it clear to the deer sector that we will expect to see a step change in the way that deer management is carried out in Scotland by the end of 2016. I think that clearly left us with the option, as you say, of either doing nothing in this bill or perhaps bringing forward a fully developed statutory system, or indeed what we've got actually in the bill, the measures that we've got there. So we looked first at the idea of a fully developed statutory system, and I think there were a number of reasons why we concluded that wasn't practicable. I mean, first of all, it would be a complex and difficult system to get right, especially to draft and bring into a bill in the relatively short time that we had. I think it would also be quite difficult to consult on such a system with a sector which was still working on the basis that there was support for the voluntary system at least until 2016. So that would have been quite a difficult thing to do. And also, I'd say on that, we would hope that the review in 2016 would itself point to the sort of direction that we think a statutory system should look like and the way that we should take that. So the other alternative of having nothing in the bill, I think, was something which we considered carefully, but we are conscious that we are on a journey with deer management. We wanted to keep that sort of direction of travel going forward, that there were measures to be in the bill, and we were very conscious that if in 2016 it became apparent that more measures were needed, we would have very little time between then and the 2020 biodiversity targets, which we're looking to meet. So we had some close consultation with SNH on what additional measures within the voluntary system might be useful that they could bring into effect at that point and help us meet the 2020 targets.
A couple of points here. I've got a kind of question about the way in which the actual assessments of, to go back to Dougie McLaren, we've assessed the shootings, and it seems that the volume of shooting, the number of beasts shot, are part of the assessment. Has there been any review of the way in which the assessment for the reintroduction of the rates would be made, other than related to the number of deer shot?
Well, clearly we've spoken with the assessors about this, just to discuss what would have to be done, and they would need to go through a process of engaging fully with the industry to work out how best to do that. I mean, there's nothing that says, subject to anything that goes into the bill, there's nothing that tells them how to value the properties. Clearly, with 100 plus years of practice leading up to 1995, that got to a certain point where the volume of the bag was used. So clearly, there's a decision to be made there if that's still going to be the best way to use that to go in future. But I think quite a lot of engagement and thought and consideration will have to sort of be undertaken before that point.
I don't think that's up to the assessors. I think it's up to us to decide whether, in fact, we want to take into account whether the process of the last 100 years is the best way to actually treat the land that we're talking about and its use.
Well, of course, if that's what Parliament wishes to do, Parliament, of course, has the right to direct the assessors how to undertake their valuations. They generally don't, but of course they can. Yeah.
But, it must have been Parliament in the first place in London that decided on the bag approach to assessment.
No.
Well, that'd be interesting to see the chapter and verse on that, because I've got the question about, the saleable value of land that includes shootings on it, are related to the number of stags which are shot on it. And it's always seemed to me to be a very unmodern way of looking at the value of that land.
Indeed, some stakeholders do criticise it. So, I mean, clearly what the assessors have a central task to make a best estimate of the hypothetical rent, and they've got different ways and methods that they can do that. They're all professional surveyors, and their valuations are tested in court. So clearly that's the context that they work in. But the history is that's been developed by the assessors over time. It wasn't, the valuation method wasn't legislated for.
Well, indeed, that's something for us to pursue further, I think, at the moment. Alec Ferguson, did you have a...
Again, Convener, thank you for letting me in. It's on a very different part of this, a different aspect of this part of the bill, probably referred to Hugh Dignon, I think. I have a real concern about this section of the bill as it would impact on the south of Scotland, where deer management is a very different thing to, I think, the sort of deer management that we're mostly looking at in this part of the bill. There are few, if any, deer management groups in that part of Scotland. I don't say we haven't got a problem with roe deer, sika, that different species of deer, but I just wonder if you can enlighten me as to how this part of the bill is going to impact in the south of Scotland, particularly given the timescales involved, the size of penalties that could be involved, and the lack of a real deer management structure in the south of Scotland at the present time.
Well, I think you're right that the focus of a lot of the attention has been on the red deer range and in Highlands, Highland Scotland, that isn't to say that there aren't concerns about what's going on in the Lowlands. And there has been quite a lot of work going on, as I'm sure you're aware, with the development of the Lowland Deer Network and a number of Lowland Deer Management Groups. I think there are 7 or 8 in place right now. There are issues surrounding impacts on, obviously, on agriculture, but also on native woodlands in Lowland Scotland, but also, crucially, deer vehicle collisions. And these are the sort of issues, I think, which SNH are working with the Lowland deer managers to develop strategies for tackling. And so that is work that is ongoing. I'm not sure that the provisions which are in this bill are designed to tackle those particular issues, although they could be brought to bear if there was a need for that to do so. For example, the power to for SNH to constitute a deer panel for the purposes of securing greater community engagement is something which could be brought to bear anywhere in Scotland where it was thought that there was a need to achieve that.
Yeah, that'll do just now. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
I think what we'll do at the moment is that we'll say thank you very much to this panel. We have a question about generally about common good, but I think we'll put it in a letter to you, which is going to be a long letter that's following on these sessions, but it would be easier from time point of view since it's not as controversial as other points just now. So I'd like to thank the witnesses in this panel. We'll take a 5-minute, absolutely 5-minute only break.
commence, and we're going to welcome panel three, who are with us, Billy McKenzie, Fiona Buchanan, Angela Morgan, Andrew Campbell, joining Trudi Sharp. Welcome to you. We'll just proceed as quickly as possible with our questions, particularly on agricultural holdings, and Alec Ferguson's going to ask the first one.
Thank you, Convener. I'm aware of time, so I'll come straight to the point, if I may, and I want to ask you about the ECHR issues in relation to Part 10 of the Bill. The policy memorandum gives quite a lot of detail on other parts of the Bill, but not a lot of detail on this part of the Bill. Can you tell me why that is, and whether you can furnish us with a greater explanation of the ECHR implications of this part?
I'm going to ask Andrew just to comment on ECHR.
Yes, good morning, everyone. I can certainly speak to the legal aspects. Policy memorandum, of course, contains most of the policy justification. If it's helpful to the committee, I can explain the Scottish Government's approach to Article 1 of Protocol 1. I'm not sure whether that's something you might prefer to have in writing.
Will it answer the question that Mr. Ferguson
quite has? Yeah. The policy memorandum does, in fact, contain information about the human rights justification for Part 10, at paragraphs 408 to 432. The way in which it's laid out admittedly doesn't name-check Article 1 or Protocol 1 directly, but if one looks through those paragraphs, you can see that each particular topic, each chapter in Part 10, has been addressed. If there are particular concerns about the justification, policy justification given in relation to the human rights paragraphs, and then obviously my policy colleagues are in a better place to assist.
So you will furnish us with a commentary on...
I'm more than happy to provide a commentary on the Scottish Government's approach to Article 1 Protocol 1, if that's helpful. Of
course. Perfect, that's what I'm looking for. Thank you very much indeed.
Okay. Any effects on those? No. Right, Jim Hume, next question.
Yeah, thank you very much, and good morning to those of you who have just joined the panel. Yes, there's been some concern. Policy memorandum, paragraph 296, states that despite the previous agricultural holding tenancy reforms, there is still an apparent lack of confidence in the sector. But we've also had quite a few submissions who have stated that this provision in the bill is still causing some concern. And a few stating that unpredictable legislative change doesn't create favourable conditions for property and land markets, letting off land as we know it. Land and estates are staying similar. The fact that there's a lack of confidence in this sector and therefore a lack of letting land. So it would be quite interesting to hear comments from the panel regarding the lack of confidence in letting land, according to a lot of the submissions due to this legislation.
I'll just make a comment and then pass to Billy. I mean, first of all, I'd just like to put on the record that the aim of this section is to create a vibrant and modern tenant sector that provides a range of letting opportunities for those who want to enter and progress within agriculture, to provide a fair return to both the landlord and the tenant, and to allow those who want to leave the industry a route to do so that allows them a reasonable return on their investment in time, labour and finances that they've put in, while ensuring that the rights of the landlord are also respected. We are aware that clearly different people have had concerns about how this is going to work in practice, and this is something that's of serious concern. I think a lot of this is about clarification rather than actually what's planned in the legislation, but I'm going to ask Billy just to expand on that.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, there are different views on this, ranging from we should take no intervention whatsoever to taking significant levels of intervention. The review group was set up to look at the agricultural holding sector to see what issues there were and what proposals we could bring forward to improve the situation if that's what needed to happen. On the back of those recommendations, we've considered what absolutely needs to be done. We believe the bill produces proposals that will have a positive impact on the sector and will continue to see letting land made available and improve the situation that is there just now. There are problems within the sector. The Scottish Government believes that taking no action would not address those problems. It would just continue to have adverse impacts on individuals' lives and on the agricultural sector as a whole. So we believe the proposals that are in the bill do provide the appropriate balance between ensuring there's fairness, that the rights and responsibilities of both parties are addressed, and the agricultural sector continues to be an important part of rural Scotland.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I think Mike Russell's wanting to come in.
Yeah, okay, Mike. Well, it's only tangentially connected, but very briefly. It seems to me that in the complexities of this, we should be listening a little bit more to some of the people who have the experience of the sector, some of whom have some quite imaginative ideas. I just want to raise two of them. One is the idea that those who have had tenancies for a very long time, and by that I'm meaning 50, 100, 150 years in their families, should be assisted in some way to move from tenancy to ownership because they have essentially created and sustained that endeavour. And I think that that is something that we'll need to look at. There are a surprising number of tenants who of course, have had a farm in the family for a very long period of time. And I don't think that we're recognising that enough. So that's one. But the second one is a specific change I just ask for consideration by the Bill team. And that's in the one of the submissions we've had from Alistair MacDonald. And it relates to the issue of the Small Landowners Acts and the way in which the transfer of small landholdings into crofting tenure, which was proposed in a legislation that I was involved in, has not actually produced the results it was meant to produce. And there are difficulties in security of tenure. And as a result of which, it seems to me that whilst we're doing this, we should tidy up some of those things that haven't worked and also looked at new things which might work.
OK, I'll come in a couple of those points. My colleagues may want to add some to the detail. In terms of long tenancies converting into ownership, that was one of the things that the review group considered. It was not considered to be an appropriate action to take if we were going to continue to have a vibrant tenancy sector. All that would do is send a message to the landowners that would lead to business decisions where tenanting land was no longer made available. We need to try and get the balance right so that tenant land does continue to be made available, but at the same time, the rights of the tenant are improved in terms of the situation that is there just now. We believe the proposals do get that balance right so that tenant land does continue to be made available, but there are options and opportunities for the tenanting sector to own their land, convert their land where that's appropriate under certain circumstances, where there's harm being created to them, etc. So we believe the balance on that is correct. Obviously, we'll listen to the parliamentary process. The Scottish Government will respond to that, but the bill puts forward the proposals that we believe creates the right balance. In terms of small landholdings, we are looking at that issue. The Scottish Government is continuing to consider that. We will be doing some research on that. Fiona, I don't know if you want to add some more detail to this.
Okay. At the end of the final group's report, we knew there was around 157 small landholding acts who had indicated on the agricultural census they were a small landholding. We surveyed all of them. We had a 74% response rate to the initial survey, basically asking for confirmation if people thought they had a small landholding or if they had another tenancy type and what the main issues they felt were for them. We're currently analysing those responses with the intention of doing more research in that area. The initial survey was just to get a handle on the locations and if our figures are correct. Now, we can share with you a map with the figures as they were before we analysed them in relation to the spread of small landholdings, because the key point for us is there are small landholdings spread across the whole country, if the figures are correct, not primarily just in the crofting areas. So whatever we do for small landholdings, we need to make it fair and equitable for parties either side of the crofting division lines.
Can I just relate both of those answers to the issue of confidence? Because I think that they have, perhaps almost unwittingly, reflected on the issue of confidence. It seems to me that we need this piece of legislation to, frankly, to settle the issues for a period of time. Because landowners say to me that the lack of confidence comes from the expectation that every piece of legislation will have a succeeding piece of legislation, and so it will go on. So if we're going to get this right, I think we should have a strong, clear and radical piece of legislation that says things have changed. If I were one of the small landowners, I'd be really worried by what I've heard, because it seems to me that we say, oh, well, we'll look at that later on. And we can't do that. We have to have because the decision is to put the agricultural tenancies issues into this bill, we have to have a conclusion to this issue. So on the small land holdings issue, we have to have a conclusion on the issue. I think it would be quite wrong to allow this piece of legislation to go past without happening. On the issue of tenancies that have been a long period, we have to have a resolution on the issue. And I think that failing to recognise the need for a conclusion to this debate at this stage will not help either side and will not increase confidence. So whatever we do, we need radical, clear solutions that are going to last. And I'm concerned by both of those answers with respect that that is not yet the view that's being taken.
I understand the point being made. We do believe that the proposals do provide the correct balance to provide the solution that we want to create a vibrant, dynamic tenanting sector, tenanting land still made available, new entrants getting into the sector, agricultural production still producing, farms modernising. The Scottish Government believes this creates the right balance. The review group did produce a very balanced set of principles, comprehensive, that their position was everything had to be done at the same time to produce all of those solutions to the appropriate extent. The Scottish Government prioritised what was within the report to ensure that actions were taken as speedily as possible to address the situations that are happening right now. The other issues that we believed we had to give more time to will be considered in the longer term.
Okay. I think the very strong view of the sector, whichever side you are on land reform, and there are people in this committee I don't agree with on land reform, whatever side you're on, needs to see a conclusion to this issue. So I think that the view that will come from this committee, I suspect, is we will have to draw a line, but the line needs to be drawn, in my view, strongly and radically in terms of change. But we have to draw that line.
We'll definitely take account, obviously, of what we're hearing today and quite appreciate and share the wish for confidence within the sector.
I think it's a fact that since two parliaments ago, we raised the question of small landholders at that stage and tried to take remedial action through the crofting route. And indeed, it has been attempted and in some cases blocked by the use of the Land Court and unnecessarily complex delaying tactics in some cases. If that's the case, there must be other people who may be suffering the same problems. So that's why Mike Russell makes the points he does. Because I remember visiting small holdings with that view when Sarah Boyack was the convener of this committee. So it is something we would underline. Right. Did you have another question, Jim? That's fine. Yes, yeah. So we'll move on to modern limited duration tenancies and Sarah Boyack. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Convener. I really want to continue that discussion we've had because I think we totally understand and support the principle of having a sustainable tenanted sector, particularly for new entrants. It's absolutely crucial. And my question really is about what is being proposed in terms of the modern limited duration tenancies and limited duration tenancies, and I'd be really quite keen for you to spell it out to us in detail exactly what the principal differences are and what the benefits are that you see. The Scottish Tenant Farming Association have said that from their perspective this is the opportunity to rebalance the relationship between landlord and tenant, and I think it picks up the point that Mike Russell made about every 3 years we have a slightly different tweak to the tenancy that is available. And you've got the tension with being very specific and the suggestion that you'd have a totally open contract model. So I think it'd be quite good for you to put on the record the specific benefits of the MLDT and really say why, to what extent you think that is a long-term solution as opposed to what we're doing in this bill, and in a couple of years there'll be another one coming along. So it's a bit about the sustainability of the proposal.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask Fiona just to respond to those points.
Just to put it into context, the amount of rented land in Scotland has declined from 30 to 23% over the last 30 years. Although recently the total area of rented land has remained broadly constant, there is a move to seasonal letting. So that's annual grass lets, annual cropping lets with no degree of support for the tenant farmer within those arrangements, because it's quite limited in relation to what they can and can't plan for in their business planning. The MLDTs, the difference between the MLDTs and the current LDTs, the key points are the review group were looking for a letting system that provided more flexibility than the current LDTs, which is why they proposed, and the Scottish Government has supported, the MLDT proposal, which will be a 10-year minimum term of tenancy, except for new entrants, where there will be an ability for a break clause for new entrants to end the tenancy, so to give a new entrant the flexibility if they feel the business isn't panning out, the relationship with the landlord is not panning out, they will have the ability to end that tenancy. The landlord will only have the ability to end that tenancy at the 5-year break clause in relation to new entrants where the new entrant is failing on the rules of good husbandry. So they've got a much stronger position as a new entrant. For the rest of the sector, going into an MLDT will also provide you with more flexibility about the rental arrangements and the purposes of the lease. There's slightly more flexibility about the fixed equipment, because we made previous legislative changes through past bills where we tried to get everybody onto the same playing field in relation to schedules of fixed equipment and get them all operating the same way at the start of leases. In practicality, that's still not working the way it could be. So the new provisions enable a bit more flex in that regard. So if you want to enter into an MLDT, we are giving you the opportunity to do that through the provisions. So for the sector, they had asked the review group for more flex, and that's where the review group reached as a position. There's no maximum term on an MLDT in the same as an LDT at the moment. Some of them last for over 20 years, and it depends on the individual circumstances of both parties. At the moment, there is no, there's no tacit relocation in the MLDT proposed. Now, we know some tenant farming stakeholders have some concerns about that, so we're willing to listen to their views around that area. In relation to, you mentioned freedom of contract, the current agricultural holding legislation across the board provides balance and protection for tenant farmers and their landlords. Freedom of contract does currently exist, but not within that formal relationship and in the legislative framework that's provided for. However, there is scope within the current agricultural holdings legislation at present for parties to take decisions between themselves to contract out of certain elements of their lease provisions. Now, unfortunately, we're not party to the details of those, because that's a separate private contractual arrangement between the parties concerned. And the review group at the time, when they considered the proposals that came forward about freedom of contract, did have concern. And they highlighted this in Section 9 of their final report, that the current circumstances in the agricultural sector were not ready to support a freedom of contract approach, because the balance between the tenant and the landlord was not as equitable as it could be.
I think that's a really helpful clarification. The only thing that occurred to me at the end was there are now quite a complex range of different tenancies, and I wonder if it would be helpful to have a kind of note saying what they are and how they're intended to work, and that will help us, I think, when we come to deciding whether or not amendments might be appropriate.
We'd be happy to provide that.
We'll include it in our long letter.
It's just got longer. So.
Indeed. That's good. Thank you. The conversion of 1991 tenancies to MLDTs is our next focus. Alec Ferguson.
And the convener's introduction states very simply exactly what that is. And I think there's an issue here I want to explore a little bit, which relates back to the point that Mike Russell made and was amplified by Sarah Boyack. Because my question really is why the conversion of 91 Act tenancies to MLDTs is being left to subsequent regulation rather than being put on the face of the bill. And the reason I ask that, and the reason I think this is important, is it comes back to this aspect of security and confidence that this is it. And I do agree with Mike Russell. There will be a lot under this bill I do not agree with Mike Russell about, but I do agree that we need to, at the end of this process, landowners in particular, those who are in a position to let land, need to feel that this is it, that they have confidence that what we pass through this Parliament is it for the foreseeable future, so that we can have that vibrant tenanted sector that every one of us around this table wants to see. I personally have reservations that this bill will achieve that, but that's for later on. So the basis of my question really is why the conversion and the details of all of that are being left to the next parliament, basically.
Billy?
Okay. The reason that we've put down the regulation-making power is due to two things. First of all, we believe the proposal to allow conversion is correct. The review group's findings were thorough on that, and we believe it is the correct thing to do. The Scottish Government believes it's the correct thing to do. Secondly, there are a wide range of options, proposals, views on what direction we should go in terms of conversion. From 15 years, 25 years, all the way up to 99 years, some as far as fuel assignation instead of conversion. There's pros and cons with all of them, there's options with all of them. Rather than put it in the face of the bill, we believe it's more appropriate to take, one, the time to work with stakeholders on all of this, to develop the appropriate options so that we get the right impact and it is a settled solution. But two, because of the wide-ranging options and the different views and pros and cons of each, it is appropriate to allow ourselves the opportunity to have a quick tweak if it is proven that the original solution doesn't work as well as what it was thought. That can sometimes happen. And leaving that type of detail to secondary legislation and allowing that flexibility going forward is believed to be the appropriate way to deal with this. That's not a settled issue. We'll listen to the Parliament on that. The debate will happen. And Scottish Government will respond to that debate. But that is the reason why we've gone for that solution at this point in time. And we are working with stakeholders and will continue to work with stakeholders to make sure that the solution brought forward is the correct one and is as final as we can possibly guarantee that to be in a very complex area with wide-ranging opinions on what to do.
I take your answer at face value, and I'm glad to hear you're still working on it. I would just make the point that three members of this committee, now all from different parties, have raised the importance of providing reassurance to all the stakeholders across the sector, and I hope you will take that with you as you continue to work on this bill, because I really do think it's fundamental.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I would just like to confirm that we absolutely will do that. We've worked very closely with stakeholders, and we will continue to do so in taking this bill forward.
To rent reviews, Claudia Beamish.
Good morning to those of you that we haven't seen in the other panels. I'd like to add my voice to those who make that plea, that same plea for the stability for the future of rural Scotland. And in that spirit, I turn to the issue of rent reviews. And obviously, this has been a very complex and taxing issue for the whole of the agricultural sector, and not long before I was involved, but I know that in committee since I've been here, it's been through the Tenant Farmers Forum, and it's been now through the Agricultural Holdings Review Group, and in section 82 of the bill, there is quite detailed there are quite detailed clauses of where we're going with the rent review, and for the record, for those who aren't clear on this, it is about the productive capacity of the land. I do have concerns that there will again be detailed regulation which doesn't, even on top of all this detail in here, that doesn't perhaps send the message that it is a settled decision when there have been so many difficulties that have forced both parties into the land court in the past. And I wonder if it's really the way forward, or whether there should be consideration of more being on the face of the bill. And why a negative rather than an affirmative procedure if indeed you do go down the road of there being... of course, there will be further regulation, but, you know, yeah, of that being the case.
So I'll ask Billy to cover most of the policy points, and then Andrew might want to just comment on the negative procedure. And again, just to reiterate that we will be seeing the what used to be called the Subordinate Legislation Committee in a couple of weeks' time.
Okay, thank you. Okay, in terms of productive capacity and what is in the bill and why regulations, it's very similar to the conversion point that productive capacity was the agreed solution from the review group. We believe that is appropriate. It is already based on practice in England, similar practice, not identical. So we believe it is the right way to go forward, but what is crucial is that we work with stakeholders on the detail, the experts within the industry. That process has already begun. We've had two meetings with all the experts and all the stakeholder bodies to develop the two crucial aspects. There's several crucial aspects. There's the definition of productive capacity. There's the other factors that you might want to take account of in that. There's a determination of fair rent, and there's the prices that you may want to take account of when assessing the productive output, the value of the productive output. All of that is incredibly complex. We've discussed it for 6 hours so far, and we are nearing a solution with the experts. And we're more than happy to provide information on the back of those meetings. There are papers that have been produced. Over the next few weeks, we should reach a settled opinion on what those factors could be, the definition of all those factors, that we could share with the committee to aid your understanding, because it is incredibly technical, very detailed. And that's why we've left it to the regulations, to allow the flexibility, even more so the conversion, the argument applies to productive capacity and all the other factors you have to take account of, that you need to allow the flexibility to tweak, because it's putting in place these practices that assessors, valuers are then going to go out and work with farmers, landowners to put in place. We may have to tweak this as we go through the process. So as I said, we are more than happy to provide the detail from the back of those meetings. We've already shared them with stakeholders. Stakeholders are helping us shape all the material that's coming forward.
Thank you. And would you envisage that process would have one of its aims would be to give reassurance to the Scottish Land and Estate concern that there hasn't been, in their view, a Scottish Government impact assessment or analysis of where this new form of productive capacity will lead in terms of rents?
In terms of the Scottish Land and Estates, they have concerns that we're going in the wrong direction. That's one opinion. There are views that say we are going in the right direction. Mm-hmm. So I think we will not completely satisfy that. Mm-hmm. What they are satisfied is that they are a full part of shaping the tool that is going to be delivered at the end of the process. So they may not agree that we should produce the tool, but they are agreeing that they are going to be a part of the process to agree what that tool should be.
And could you give us any view, which I suspect you can't, but I'm going to ask the question anyway, as to whether this new form of rent review, taking into account unproductive capacity, is likely to put rents up or down?
That is impossible for anyone to say. Again, there are wide-ranging views on what that
could happen. But there are different views from different sectors, as I understand it.
They're split.
So has there been any assessment of where that might be going?
At this point in time, there's been consideration by the review group. There's been reference to what happened in England. It's too uncertain. There's too many different factors that feed into this. The price levels in future agricultural produce is one factor that is completely unknown that will feed into the productive capacity and what the rent will be. There's individual business decisions that will feed into what the individual rents will be. It is too uncertain an area. What this will do is increase the transparency within the process so that people can have an informed debate on what the rent should be, rather than what many say is a mystical, non-transparent process just now.
Kindly give us some information about what the advantages of it are from the perception of having looked at the English system. As a committee, I think it would be helpful if we could see something briefly about that.
We could provide that along with all the other information
that
we're providing.
Thank you.
Could I just ask if you're doing this on the basis of modelling different sorts of potential rents for extensive sheep farms, for intensive arable, etc., etc.? Is that how you're proceeding?
That is the intention. Once we have a proposal that we believe defines productive capacity, takes account of all the other factors, etc., the intention is to go out and test it on a wide range of farms. We already have volunteers to allow us to do that, and the valuers are going to help us with that process.
Thank you very much. All right. Okay, and that we'll move on to succession and assignation. Angus MacDonald.
With regard to sections 84 and 87 of the bill, section 84 amends section 10A of the 91 Act to widen the classes of family member to whom the 91 Act tenancies could be assigned, and section 87 seeks to amend section 11 of the 91 Act to widen the classes of family member to whom the 91 Act tenancy could be bequeathed. So the bill substantially widens the potential successors. Now, the NFUS, in their submission, broadly welcomed the move, stating that the policy aim, stating that if the policy aim is to extend the lifespan of secure tenancies, then the proposals in the bill will aid this. However, they say if the policy aim is to address unfairness of death out of turn or the inability of direct family to take over a business, then the proposals seem to go wider than what's required. So can you explain what the policy intention is of this part of the bill? Is it to extend the lifespan of secure tenancies, or is it to address unfairness of death out of turn or the inability of direct family to take over a business?
I'm going to ask Fiona to comment in a moment, but the aim behind this is to encourage tenants and to enable tenants to retire and move on at a time that they deem appropriate in order to release land to younger tenants and ensure that land continues in productive agricultural use. So that's the broad position that we were coming at this from. The particular circumstances that the NFUS refer to would be two of the categories of the situations that might arise where this might apply.
In addition, the provisions modernise the class of successor to reflect modern family structures and bring the provisions into line, providing the same rights for succession by bequest, transfer by an executor or assignation. As I'm sure you're aware, modern family structures have changed quite considerably in recent years, and this impact also applies equally to farming families. The current legislation can have discriminatory consequences at present by not providing a spouse with the same equal rights as their partner upon the death of the partner. It also doesn't provide fairness to the sibling who is the partner of the business upon that person's death, because tenancies are normally in the name of a named individual as opposed to a company name. So if you are the partner in that company and your brother or sister dies, you have no guarantees of being able to take on the tenancy, so your farming business would end. In our research in 2014 in the tenant farming survey, we had a response rate of 3,095 to that survey. 20% of respondents had a family member who wanted to succeed the tenancy, but who currently fall out with the current class of eligible successor. And over half of those individuals identified the person to be a sibling, while a third said it was going to be a niece or nephew. The provisions also enable us to address issues of death out of turn, where unfortunately somebody dies and the members of the family are perhaps too young to take on the tenancy at that point of time. So that family farm would then fall out of agricultural tenancy. The provisions would enable it to go back up the family tree and across and along and down to provide protection for the family farm and enable a continuation of agricultural tenancies.
Okay, I think I've covered that. Just for clarification, was consideration given to allowing open a non-family assignation of the 91 Act tenancies?
In relation to that, the Agricultural Holding Review Group considered this proposal and concluded within Section 7 of their final report that the change would create significantly long-term inflexibility within the agricultual sector for 1990-91 tenancies and could reduce the confidence of landlords to make land available in the future, thus defeating the purpose of the objective of a viable tenanted farming sector. They also concluded the public interest case for such a change had not been made to them. Instead, they recommended to the Scottish Government that we consider conversion, which, as Billy's explained, we're currently exploring as the alternative solution to provide the flexibility to adapt to more modern farming. I know some stakeholders have raised concern about they would like it restricted to somebody involved in the agricultural business, but because of modernisation of Scottish agriculture, if you are not a direct family member who can work on that particular farm and you want to farm, you'll have to go off farm to do that. So if you limit it to those directly involved, you would then end up in arguments about, you know, your brother who had to go off and farm on another farm because there wasn't enough to support two farmers on the farm. So it's quite important that that it's flexible enough to adapt to modern farming and be fit for the future.
Okay, thank you.
Now, Alec Ferguson and then Dave Thompson.
Thanks, Convener. I think I would have to say, I would argue that if one is going to address modern farming, and farming changes all the time, there also needs to be flexibility within the system to allow holdings to be reconfigured when they become vacant in order to make adjustments to suit different farming techniques. And I don't think that is helped by the assignation proposals here. But my question, I've got two very brief questions. One, if the intention, as you say, rightly, is to achieve greater churn within the sector, what are the ways of looking at that? Because I think there are other ways that could have been achieved necessarily without a straight assignation proposal. My other question is it envisaged, and I probably should know this, but I don't, forgive me, is it envisaged that the landlord will have a right to take on an assignation at a value? When it comes up, obviously.
I'd like to ask my colleague, Angela Morgan, to talk about what we've done in relation to other opportunities for new entrants.
Mm-hmm. With the assignation proposals, it is hoped that this will open up new opportunities for new entrants, but there are also other aspects of the bill, and we've spoken about this earlier. In relation to the MLDTs, we think that the five-year break clause after 5 years will lead to an increase in let land because it will make landowners more confident in those inexperienced farmers. The Scottish Government is also looking at share farming opportunities, so there are other elements that we are looking at in terms of new entrants. So it's not just the assignation proposals, but that's part of it.
Thank you. I'm grateful for that, but my question wasn't totally related just to new entrants. It won't only be new entrants that take on assignations. It'll be farmers, sons, nephews, all sorts of others who may well and probably should be involved in farming already. So I think how you classify new entrants is a bit open to interpretation, like much of this bill seems to be. But I'm sure we can drill down into that later. Could you address the second point about whether a landlord will have a right of taking on an assigned lease?
On the second point, I'd like to come back to you on that in writing because it's quite technically complicated and there are lots of provisions relating to that and interlink with the 2003 Act as the provisions are currently drafted in the bill.
No, that would be fine if you would. Thank you.
Very much. Dave Thompson.
Welcome to the new members of the panel. Just to tease out a wee bit more, the open assignation. Was consideration given to the fact that open assignation to anyone would actually simplify the situation and give greater certainty, because then people would know absolutely that that tenancy was a tenancy that could go to anyone, so that would be absolutely certain. Everyone would know where they stood, and it would allow for a flexibility, for the tenants at the moment, these secure tenants, and this is what we're talking about, which you're not going to get otherwise to the same extent. If you leave it to the family member situation, and I can understand some of the arguments as to why you would do that, then inevitably there's going to be a continuing reduction in the number of tenants over time, maybe at a slower pace than we've seen in recent times. So I just wonder if you could elaborate a wee bit more on that.
Sure. Cover that. There's already a reduction in tenancy land, as you've heard. So tenancy land is reduced significantly over a fairly short period of time. If the Scottish Government had legislated for full assignation, so to keep perpetual tenancies, there's a fairly sure result that landlords would no longer make any more tenancy land available.
Well, can I just come in here? So we're talking about secure 1991 tenancies. And the current road we're going down, you've just said there's been a big reduction in recent times, This is going to allow for continuing reduction. It's not going to lead to any new ones being established. And different letting vehicles, I haven't heard anyone arguing that other letting vehicles, SLDTs, modern tenancies or whatever, would infer any rights, you know, in the long term as such. It's the 1991 tenancies, which are a very specific group of tenants that we're talking about here. So I'm not sure I accept the premise that it would continue, because it would give absolute certainty. And if it was clear around the table that everybody was agreeing that this is something to deal with those tenancies, and there was absolutely no intention that any other tenancies would be picked up by this, would that not give the certainty we're looking for?
That is a view that some hold. Based on the findings of the review group and the consideration that we've given to that, the Scottish Government is trying to maintain confidence within the letting sector as a whole. And landlords will base their business decisions from what they've told the review group, and the review group understood that, on what is happening to the letting sector as a whole. So if we decrease their confidence, if we increase their concern that their business choices are going to continually be curtailed, then we could face a situation where tenancy land is no longer made available. And that would be a significant problem for Scottish agriculture, because we want to ensure there's a range of opportunities for new entrants and those progressing up the ladder. So it's not just about new entrants. We have to get the balance between the rights and responsibilities of the landlord and the rights and responsibilities of the tenant correct throughout all aspects of this bill. There are differing opinions on whether we've achieved that or not. The Scottish Government believes that this bill does achieve that in the appropriate way to ensure that we get the impact that the Scottish agriculture needs.
Just one quick follow-on, Convener. The range of family members that can take over tenancies has been increased pretty massively, I suppose you could say. It's only a small step to have open assignation. So why would the current proposals lead to less letting by landlords, but open assignation wouldn't, given that there's not a big degree of difference between the range of people who will be able to?
I couldn't define the degree of difference, to be honest. There is a difference, and it would be a strong message that's stronger than what we believe assignation and succession provides. We believe that's an improvement in terms of the current situation, but we don't believe it is appropriate to go as far as full assignation. I'm going to pause here because I don't know if Andrew wanted to come in.
Yeah, so it's only a matter of degree, really. I'm not sure I would agree with your conclusions, but it's something that we can obviously deal with as the bill moves through the process.
Thanks, Steve. Mike Russell.
Just an observation. I mean, the more I hear of this and the more I read these submissions and the more I talk to people, I think that nobody really believes that this will settle the matter. And that's the real problem that I think we're going to have to confront as this bill goes through and as the process of amendment takes place. Because if it is true that, and it may well be true, that the lack of confidence will grow the wider there is assignation, the logic of that is to return to a very narrow situation in which assignation is very restricted. But in terms of the health of rural communities, the health of families, I mean, we've just heard from Fiona the issue of families involved, the other logic in that is that we should be much wider in our assignation, and indeed eventually you go from family assignation to what David Thompson has referred to as open assignation. With a fit and proper person test, which I think is essential, and with the possibility of assignation at value to landlords, which is something that we haven't yet discussed but which is there, then you might be able to construct a situation which was stable. But I'm not sure you will construct a situation that is stable by simply making incremental changes on both sides and hoping that somebody is going to end up happy. That doesn't seem to me to be a recommendation for progress. I'm not asking for comment on it. I just do think that we have a real conundrum in here which we are going to have to address.
Could I briefly comment, nevertheless, to say that, as Billy's described, it is a balance that we've put into the bill at the moment. It will be very interesting as the committee takes evidence on whether or not that balance appears to be the right one with the differing views, or whether a different balance seems to be right. But what we have done here is attempt to take account of the varying views and what we're hearing, the representations that we've heard, and provide something that we hope provides an improvement for tenants whilst also giving confidence to the landlords. But I'm no doubt you'll be wanting to take evidence from the different parties on this.
Everything all the time. Yep. And I think that the question here is, can you have continued or increased confidence whilst respecting the rights of tenants and the human rights of those who are involved and the health of communities? And I think that's a decision we will have to come to. Certainly at the present moment, I think the rights of tenants and the health of communities weighs more heavily with me.
That being said, I think we'll move on to the question of WAGO and the amnesty for improvements. So, Graham Day.
Thank you, Kabir, and I'll be as brief as I can. I wonder if you could explain the rationale for the bill providing for a 2-year period for serving an amnesty notice, as opposed to the 3-year suggested by the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group, and the thinking behind not including in the bill an updated list of eligible improvements to reference and reflect modern circumstances, when the list as it stands was actually compiled more than 70 years ago.
I'm going to ask Angela to deal with these points.
For the majority of cases, it is anticipated that 2 years will be sufficient to resolve the issues. The sooner parties can reach clarification on this matter, the better. Obviously, for some individuals, the final length of the amnesty period will go beyond the 2 years if they apply to the Land Court towards the end of the 2-year period. We are listening to stakeholders' views on this matter, however, and we will carefully consider all the evidence gathered. But at the moment, we think 2 years should be sufficient to resolve the issues. In relation to the schedule of eligible improvements, we are aware that this is quite outdated, but we are working with the industry bodies to come up with a more modernised, suitable list, and that's something we are progressing.
So we will get there.
Yes.
We have that undertaking, yes. Mm-hmm. Right, that's good to have on the record. Thank you.
Right, well, thank you very much for that. We're going to conclude there just now. I'd like to thank you all for your contributions. The committee is going to write to you after the meeting with a list of additional and follow-up questions, as you know, and we will call a short suspension now so as to change over witnesses. Thank you. Agenda item 3 is a review of veterinary disease surveillance centres, and it's to take evidence on the review of veterinary disease surveillance centres from the Scottish Rural University College, and our witnesses today are from the Commercial Division SAC Consulting. And I welcome Mike Weinberg, the Managing Director of SAC Consulting, and Brian Hosey, the Head of SAC Consulting Vet Services. And we will have a short opening statement from Mike Weinberg, and then we will proceed to some questions. So welcome, gentlemen. Look forward to what you have to say.
Thank you very much. Can I just say that we are very pleased to have this opportunity to share our position with you. And if I can just then go through this opening statement, which is just to say that you'll be aware that the stakeholder consultation ran from the 2nd of June to the 10th of July. And we've considered the responses very thoroughly that we received to that. And some arising work is still ongoing. This process inevitably results in a great deal of uncertainty for staff, particularly those at the affected sites. No decisions have yet been concluded with regard to our next steps, and therefore no announcements have been made. Procedurally, once we've reached a decision on next steps, our staff and the unions would be the first to be made aware. And a formal staff consultation would then be initiated. Convener, may I therefore respectfully request that the committee members bear in mind this in mind, given the public nature of this hearing. I'd just now like to outline the SRUC's role in the decision-making process on animal disease surveillance. SRUC, through its commercial division, SAC Consulting, delivers veterinary surveillance and public good advisory services under a memorandum of understanding with Scottish Government. Following a recommendation from the CNAD report, the Scottish Government established an independent strategic management board to advise on the future of veterinary disease surveillance in Scotland. And the three independent members of that SMB were appointed by the Cabinet Secretary, and the SMB is chaired by the Chief Veterinary Officer of Scotland. SAC Consulting has considerable technical expertise in the area of animal disease surveillance, and as the main operational protagonist, SAC Consulting works with and through the Strategic Management Board on matters affecting the strategic direction of disease surveillance in Scotland, and we've been doing this for the last 3.5 years. In terms of our memorandum of understanding with Scottish Government, there are areas where SAC Consulting is required to obtain specific permissions in order to proceed. Just a few words on disease surveillance itself. If I just outline that there are basically two areas, broad areas of disease surveillance. The majority of our activities at our 8 disease surveillance centres across Scotland involve vets, farmers, crofters, others submitting carcasses and other specimens to our laboratory facilities as part of what's termed passive surveillance. And this relies on the initiative being taken by the individual vet farmer to submit that material to us. So passive surveillance on the one hand, active surveillance on the other is where the initiative is taken perhaps by us, perhaps by others, to actively investigate what is believed to be a disease trend. This might be on the basis of information that's become apparent on the basis of data that's out in the available to them, etc. So just to highlight those two differences, passive versus active surveillance, and perhaps to emphasize that we have ambitions to use both forms of the surveillance more closely as we go forward, and we'd be happy to talk about that. The other point I wanted to mention was that disease surveillance as such around the world has been receiving attention in terms of the way that it is carried out. And specifically in Scotland, I should make you aware that the disease surveillance infrastructure dates back to the 60s and 70s in many cases, since when, of course, the structure of farming has changed very significantly. Livestock numbers have by and large decreased significantly. And furthermore, government approaches to public funding, not just in Scotland, but in other parts of the world as well, have changed significantly too. So there's now a need to modernize our approach to disease surveillance in order to deliver high quality output and the best value for money for the taxpayer. And indeed, this was recognized by the CNAD report when they published in 2011. We need to make better use of passive and active surveillance. We need to ensure that the widest and best use is made of the knowledge and skills of the broader veterinary and farmer communities. And we believe that we should be making better use of modern technology in order to join up this information and coordinate it better. So it was against this backdrop and more recently the acute pressure of budgetary cuts that SRUC was prompted to move to a stakeholder consultation on the 2nd of June this year, which was in fact one day after I started this job with SAC Consulting. One final introductory point, which I hope helps as a point of clarity. SRUC has the following operations based at Drummond Hill in Inverness. The first one is a disease surveillance centre which provides a post-mortem facility to local vets and farmers. The second one is a laboratory facility which will then test the specimens that arise from those post-mortems or perhaps other samples that have been submitted from vets and farmers. There's also a marine mammal strandings team that is based there. Fourthly, an epidemiology team. And fifthly, the Farm Business Consultancy Office. So five separate groups, a total of 49 members of staff work at the site. 15 of those involved in the Disease Surveillance Center and the Marine Strandings team, and 34 in the epidemiology team and Farm Business Consulting. SRUC concluded to support the University of the Highlands and Islands Science Park in Inverness by transferring the epidemiology and farm business services consultancy team to the new campus when that opens in the first quarter of next year. But the Disease Surveillance Centre was not included in that move, as we were still at that point in discussion with the SMB about the future of disease surveillance across Scotland. I hope that helps just to set the scene.
Yes, indeed. Thank you. Initially, our questions were about, you know, basically you've told us why disease surveillance in Scotland is important and how the DSCs relate to broader issues. But in the circumstances, you've talked about having eight centres in the country. And you've said that you want to rationalise these. I think we're going to get on to some of the details of just exactly how you relate to some of the different reviews that have been done and so on. But in terms of the Inverness Centre, one of the points was that it's you know, there to support crofting communities and the work of the Outbreak Committee of NHS Highland. Can you tell us how that works or what level of work is involved in that?
I could perhaps help you there, Mr. Convener. The principal reason that we have our eight disease surveillance centres around Scotland is to engage with the local livestock farming enterprises and their veterinary practitioners. We operate through the veterinary practitioners. We are consultants to the private vets in the field. And to undertake our disease surveillance role on behalf of the government for which we get government funding, we require to receive submissions coming in. And the most valuable submissions that we receive are, of course, postmortems. because that allows us really to get down to the nuts and bolts, the gritty details of why an animal is died or failed to thrive. And it's us looking at this material in depth that gives us the opportunity to monitor disease trends and to look out for new and re-emerging diseases. And we've got a good record on that. So, you know, over the years we've picked up things like, well, most recently we've had Schmallenberg virus, which you may be aware of, calling deformities in calves and lambs. And we've had the bleeding calf syndrome before that. Now, with respect to individual sites, and you mentioned Inverness, you know, it's important that our vets engage with the community and solicit and ensure we get a good supply of material in. And in discussions with the Strategic Management Board, with whom we've been in close dialogue over the past, well, nearly three and a half years, we've, you know, recognising that post-mortem submissions is the main determinant as to why a centre should be retained and what we need to do there. And unfortunately, Inverness, we've recognised there that we're not getting the submissions of postmortems that we would really be looking for. It's at the bottom of our league table, if we want to use such a term, you know, less than Thurso, less than all of our other sites. We're seeing about 240, 250 postmortem submissions across cattle, sheep, pigs, poultry, game birds in a year. And it's that factor that we said, right, we need to be thinking, is there a better way of dealing with the service to ensure that we are actually delivering for the area? And that's where we've engaged. And if I could use in contrast, you know, if we look at cattle submissions, we're looking at our centres across the piece dealing with something like 1,300 or 1,400 cattle diagnostic submissions a year, post-mortem diagnostic submissions a year. Only 80-odd of them are coming into Inverness. You know, so that's the kind of driver that we need to be looking at to be doing our job. And this is where we've engaged in the consultation, trying to open up other opportunities for delivering services.
But you've said nothing about serving the crofting communities or working with the outbreak committee of NHS Highland.
Well, with regard to the crofting communities, the veterinary practitioners are supported to deliver, private veterinary are supported through the Highlands and Islands Veterinary Services Scheme. And the Frieda Scott Park has a leading role in managing that scheme, and she, of course, is on the Strategic Management Board. So we do have that engagement there.
But we're talking about the fact that private vets don't want to take on a larger that job of doing post-mortems.
Yes. Well, that's what they've said, and it's. I think it's unfortunate that compared to other parts of the country, they've closed their minds to that. It would be nice for them to have perhaps seen the opportunity to help their business, but we'll have to go back and reconsider on that, Mr. Convener, without doubt. And that's one of the feedbacks that we got from the consultation. That we will have to engage in a new way with this area because, as I say, if we look at any measures, be it the number of holdings in the area or indeed the livestock numbers, that it's, if you look at these ratios to the numbers of postmortems we're getting, it's that the Inverness is just not getting these submissions in.
I think we'll have a look at that in a little more detail. An aspect of this, Graham Day wants to take.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah. Good afternoon, as it is now. In referring to the 240 to 250 postmortems a year that you deal with, you reference game birds, for example. But I wonder, do you in any way deal with the consequences of wildlife crime, raptor poisonings, that sort of thing? And if you do, are you not seeing an upsurge in the numbers of there?
Yes, we do support various people in carrying out postmortems, forensic postmortems, forensic pathology across not just raptors, but you know, wild mammals as well. And that is supported financially by our activities with the Scottish Government. We're seeing roughly 200-odd bird carcasses, wild bird carcasses a year across our 8 sites. It varies from year to year as to where it's perhaps busiest, as you might say, particularly when it comes to the crime. And of course, unfortunately, as you know, in Inverness, there's been a spate of raptor poisonings this last wee while. And our teams work closely with the authorities on that. We've ensured our veterinary staff have had appropriate training to give support to the fiscal if it comes to prosecutions, and have got the correct evidence.
I would guess you give a figure there of roughly 200 across the eight sites, but I would have thought the majority of these were concentrated in the likes of Inverness, perhaps Perth. These sites, it won't be a general sort of average spread, will it?
Well, it varies year to year as to where the birds are coming in. I'm not just talking about the iconic species as well. Of course, we can get finches and other birds. And one of my previous colleagues has worked very closely with the RSPB and the Garden Bird Survey. And it's important that we see this because, of course, these carcasses we do screen also for not just thinking of crime, but also thinking of infectious diseases, avian influenza, West Nile virus. So samples are taken as part of the GB strategy, looking to see has there been an incursion of these exotic viruses.
But in terms of the recent, the past year or the recent years, one would assume there's perhaps been an upsurge in the volume of the likes of raptor poisoning postmortems in Inverness.
Well, no, I think there's a greater realisation of the importance of wildlife crime. I don't know if there's any more of it. In fact, I think the evidence from Scottish Agricultural Science Agency data is that there's an encouraging downward trend. And I think, it's good that there's a general acceptance of the importance within the community that we've got to tackle this type of issue. So, I wouldn't like you to think that we're not cognizant of the fact that we are dealing with these, but the principal reason that we have our eight DSCs is to provide support to the veterinary practices and the livestock farming. The dealing with the wildlife crime and wildlife as a whole is very much seen as supplementary, and people who are willing to bring in carcasses from these type of species will often be willing to travel that bit further.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dave Thompson.
Yeah, thank you very much, convener, and good afternoon, gentlemen. I just want to tease out a wee bit more about the Inverness site and the distances that are involved in the Highlands and Islands just to get anywhere, and maybe that's part of the reason why not so many people, lots of whom have very small holdings, and it's expensive and difficult and time-consuming, to get to Inverness. These folk are going to find it even more difficult, expensive and time-consuming to get to Aberdeen or Thurso or the Central Belt, to take animals along to you. There's also a kind of general principle here, I think, that we need to bear in mind. If we always base our decisions in relation to Highlands facilities on the fact that they're a bit smaller than facilities in the rest of the country, we'll continue to denude the Highlands of these facilities, because the logic will be that the small ones, the Highland ones, always have to be the ones that go. And we need some reverse thinking, I think, in relation to this, if we're going to help to develop and build the Highlands and Islands. And believe you me, the Highlands and Islands needs a lot of help. So that's the first sort of point I would make. And following on from that, and looking at the map of the locations of your sites, it would seem to me that it would be far more logical to keep the Inverness site open, but to shut your Edinburgh DSC. Because down in the Central Belt area, you've got another four that cover geographically a very good spread. It would be relatively easy for folk. Your roads are far better for a start, so it's much easier to drive down a motorway or a dual carriageway than it is to come from Skye on pretty poor Highland roads. So I would just like to pose that point to you, first of all, about a bit of reverse thinking here.
Well, thank you, Mr. Thompson, for that suggestion. I mean, we're certainly, I think, very alert to the fact that, they are at a disadvantaged areas, and SRUC, SAC Consulting is, very alert to the needs of the more remote and disadvantaged communities. We have got our advisory service throughout Scotland, including the Outer Hebrides and Skye and what have you. So we are, you know, alert to these problems. And I think what we're trying to do is to say, right, are there better ways of working in this area to take advantage of new technologies to support the practices in the area and yet to provide a better service? And you're quite right that, you know, we're a large number of small units in the Highlands and Islands. We reckon there's 25% of the livestock holdings, about 5,500 livestock holdings in the region served by the Inverness Centre. Unfortunately, because of exactly the point you were making about distances and the fact that farmers tend to be working with, you know, willing to travel about 30 miles, about 50 kilometres, that we're getting most of the work coming in there, but there's only about 20% of the holdings in that catchment area. So there's about 1,000 holdings in that area. And as you say, some of them are not very large businesses. We've got 60% of the holdings are more than 100 kilometres away from Inverness. So, you know, we're starting to say, right, you know, this is just a disadvantage all the way through. How can we do the job better? And we've been exercising our minds. We've been speaking to our strategic management board. And, of course, we've had the consultation responses. And we've got some ideas that we're working up at present as to how we could do the job better to mutual benefit. You know, we can only provide our disease surveillance activities by working with the practices, by working with the farmers, to deliver them with a diagnostic service that they can benefit from, but we benefit from the surveillance information. Now, is that...
Well, it doesn't fully answer my question, no, yes. Sorry. And if you do away with the Inverness DSC, then all those farmers who are currently using it, and crofters and so on, will certainly not go to Thurso or Aberdeen, which are the next nearest ones. So you lose all of them if they'll only travel 50 kilometres. So you immediately get rid of all of that. So you basically then have no data in the Inverness and West Highland areas coming into your system. I wouldn't have thought that would be very clever.
At all, and we're actively exploring alternatives, some of which were raised by the consultation. You know, there was somebody who was suggesting there was a need for itinerant service, this sort of thing. You know, should our vets be based up there but working out in the community and things of that nature? So, you know, these are ideas. They're not ones that we can just switch on overnight. We've got to do our homework and you know, make sure that we've got that sorted out. But that was one of the benefits that came out. We've had some really very helpful comments coming into that consultation. And I think you've actually received the summary in your papers today.
Would you see any benefits in your overall costings and so on? You're trying to save money here in closing your Edinburgh DSC and that workload going to the four DSCs round and about it?
We are trying to work with the Kinnaird recommendations that were produced following a two-year review in 2011. And one of these was that we should be working with the vet schools. We're very fortunate in Scotland. We've got two world-class vet schools in both Edinburgh and Glasgow. And so it would make sense that we maintain that facility in Edinburgh such that the undergraduates, who are, after all, our future veterinary surgeons, have got greater exposure to veterinary pathology and live veterinary pathology, not the sort of pickled specimens that I, unfortunately, had to deal with when I was an undergraduate 40 years ago. But we're trying to deal with real cases.
It's not very far from Edinburgh to the borders. You know, you're less than an hour from the map there, so your students could easily get their experience they need in a DSC if they did that. If you're wanting to ensure you raise money from the Drummond Hill site, which is a very valuable site, then you could move the Inverness DSC to Dingwall, and you'd still be able to get a good price for the Drummond Hill site and probably get a much cheaper site and a new facility through in Dingwall. So I'd ask you to consider that as well.
Certainly, in a very fair point about Dingwall, and that was one of the things that came back from the consultation, was the many of the vets and farmers felt that the existing site at Drummond Hill was really inappropriate in its location. Access was poor. The fact it's an urban situation beside primary school and what have you. And they were very keen that we consider somewhere like Dingwall as being more of a natural hub for the area. So these were, I think, positive points. Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Re-emphasise the point that Dave Thompson made and really cut through this. If I look at the commentary on your announcement from the people in the Highlands and Islands who have used your service, social media and other commentary, it is entirely negative. People do not want this to happen. Your service users do not want this to happen. And regrettably, you know, and it's a little unfair to you because you're coming to this committee on one issue, whereas those of us who are Highland members see lots of other issues, regrettably you are simply confirming that what is taking place, you know, regularly is that organisations say, well, you know, we don't have enough critical mass where in the Highlands and Islands, so let's just move somewhere else, and let's tell them that this is going to be a better service because we've got new technology. Now, that could be the case sometime in the future, but it's not going to be the case now. It's not going to be the case for many people in the Highlands and Islands whose access to broadband is poor, whose access to mobile phone technology is poor. So until there is a clear alternative, which people, your users say, that's much better, that's really what we're looking for, then you shouldn't be doing it. And I mean, it's as simple as that, speaking as a Highland representative. You know, because Highland representatives really need to say, stop withdrawing services, make sure those services are provided near to us, and as Dave says, if there is a requirement to close places which are, there are alternatives within easy travelling distance. I mean, it's sort of open and shut, and I'm sorry to be so clear and blunt, but sometimes it's necessary to be clear and blunt in these circumstances. You just have to pay attention to what the people who use you want, and they don't want it closed.
If I could respond to that, having just spent considerable time since arriving travelling around the Highlands and Islands, I now have a good idea of some of the demographics, the topography of the area and the remoteness of some of the parts that we're trying to cover. And I'm also aware, in the light of the consultation that we've had, the sensitivities that there are about the depletion of all the issues that you've just mentioned. So quite aware of that. I think in trying to fit our concerns from a veterinary perspective, the focus here being on disease surveillance around, so the technical aspects of disease surveillance around the budgetary constraints that we have. We have also started, and I have to say that much of these thoughts have come out of the consultation, that we can segment the different services that we're providing. And if I was just to sketch out where we think we could be going in the longer term,
sort of thing which you could have given us in writing before this, because you know we're talking about the immediate issue about you moving to a service in the future which might well develop in a particular scientific way, but at the moment we're talking about centres which are under threat as a result of that.
Yes, okay, if I respond very
I'm respect for the putting forward, and I'm sure that they are, you know, by your own parameters, the arguments you believe are correct. There is, however, an equal and opposite point of view from the people who use you, who require this service, and the issue of rurality is very heavy in these scales. By all means, I'm sure the committee will read what you provide to them on this, but the weight of evidence from my constituents, Dave's constituents, Rob's constituents, is heavily against these changes, and I hope your organisation will bear that very much in mind.
We will bear it in mind, and we do recognise that, and certainly the response to the consultation comes across very strongly. So we, in our thoughts about where we are and where we're going forward, we do not have an immediate intention to leave an absence of access to our services, the key service being the availability of a facility in order to do postmortems.
No, I'm sorry, I must press you just to make that point. When you use that phrase is not the same as saying, I'm sorry, we're not going to do this action, because this action actually is the wrong action for the people who use us. So absence of access to our services, right, implies there are different ways of delivering these and we'll just do that. There are people who say, we don't want you to change what you're doing at present, because we do not, with the greatest of respect, believe that that access will be adequate. That is, I think, where I am, where Dave is, where others are, and that's the position we're representing to you.
And then Sarah Boyack, we will be broadening this out to the whole Scotland Review in a minute.
Yeah. Well, it's just on that, convener. I'm conscious that Auchincruith hasn't been mentioned yet. Now, I'm not sure how many submissions have been received in the consultation. However, you have no doubt noticed a submission by my colleague Adam Ingram, MSP for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, who, as you'd expect, believes that the Air DSC should be retained at Auchincruith, and he makes a number of very strong points in the submission. And to quote just partly from his submission, he says, "The farming community in the southwest of Scotland are bitterly resentful at what they see as a forced expropriation of a valuable part of farming infrastructure which sustained their activities. They wish to see the existing centre maintained at Nellie's Gate." He also goes on to say, "It's clear the removal of the comprehensive post-mortem service and sample processing facility at Auchincruith will significantly reduce demand for these services in one of the most livestock-dense areas of Scotland. This will impact very negatively on livestock disease surveillance in Scotland, and the risks to Scottish farming far outweigh the benefits to be accrued from small cost savings." And just finally, just picking out another point that he states. My understanding of the Kinnaird report findings was that the Strategic Management Board were tasked with creating and implementing a new strategic vision for veterinary surveillance in Scotland, which may include the reduction in the number of DSCs. This consultation fails utterly to place the potential closure of two sites in the context of delivering any kind of vision. It appears simply to be an exercise in cost cutting by centralisation. Now, I'd be keen to hear your view on, in particular, the Auchincruith facility, given the view of Adam Ingram, MSP.
Well, thank you very much. And I did speak on the telephone to Mr Ingram during the consultation, so thank you, Mr McDonald. Well, the situation with regard to the Air Auchincruith DSC is one of our busiest centres, and in contrast with Inverness, we were talking about 244 submissions of carcasses a year. On average, we're looking at something like 600-odd at Auchincruith, so a very different situation there. It's serving an important livestock area, and I mean, you're criticised or suggested that there was a lack of vision. The vision that we were adopting was that laid out in the Kinnaird review that it was conducted over a two-year period in 2010-2011. And in that, it was thought that there was benefits, or agreed that there were benefits in working closely with the two vet schools, in this case, the vet school in Glasgow. And so we've had a close dialogue with them. They were actively involved in the consultation with us. They attended the meetings that were held at the racecourse with farmer and veterinary surgeons in the area. And yes, we are taking on board the concerns. Obviously, there would be farmers who would benefit, i.e. they would be closer to the, if there was a PM facility created at Glasgow Vet School, then we could have served them better. Unfortunately, that would have been to the detriment of some who are already enjoying easy access. But we are working with the Glasgow University to try to find another way of working together that meets the aspirations laid out in the Kinnaird review, where there's this vision, as I explained to Mr. Thompson earlier on, about the undergraduates benefiting from access to this post-mortem material.
Undergraduates have got to be sent out to all the conditions around the country that they're likely to meet. Indeed, to encourage them to take up posts there. We can't get private vets in the Highlands because people are dissuaded from doing large animal veterinary medicine. The whole process of vet training may be based in two places, but in order to give the students an opportunity to find out what the rest of the country's like, they have to go out. So whether the college is actually, or the vet service is near to the college, is neither here nor there. I think you need to give us a cost-benefit analysis of what you proposed, because that's something we have not heard. That's the nub of the matter, which we need to know about just now. And I'm beginning to sort of lose the point that there's a whole lot of very useful questions to go for. Time is short, but we actually need to know why it is that you've adopted this approach, because SRUC has got track records on this. Back in 2003, they wanted to close Auchincruith. They wanted to close Thanestone and those sort of areas and centralise things in Edinburgh. Well, we were there at that time and we're seeing it happening again. So give us your cost-benefit analysis about this right now.
Convener, there's no doubt that we are under significant budgetary pressures, and that will have a bearing on what we're having. Effectively, 10% of our budget has been withdrawn. So that has undoubtedly had an impact on some of the decision-making, and that's a reality we have to face. I think as far as the infrastructure of services is concerned, we are attempting to think through the whole process in a slightly different way in order to keep the access to facilities available in the areas that... available in all the areas that are covered at the moment. So in terms of farmers having a location to which they can take animals to have a post-mortem done, that we do everything we can to retain that. And that's our current thinking on this issue. We still believe that we can go some way to doing that. We haven't finished the exercise entirely. But in the process of doing so, we need to find some savings. We're under pressure to do that.
Can you ask your question at the moment? Because I'm not getting an answer to what the cost-benefit analysis is.
Which is part of my question, so I'll come on.
Yeah,
so
right.
I think you might want to go to Mr. Hume, but I mean, I think a lot of the ground that I was going to ask about has been covered. But the question there does seem to me, with the best will in the world, that there's an element of putting cart before horse here, especially given the amount of time that's elapsed between the Cadair report being published and this consultation. And if you look at the Inverness situation, it appears that the decision taken to make the changes that you've put forward, and yet the suggested alternative, such as greater use of private vets, hasn't been tested. And I'm horrified to hear that Mr. Jose Bryan, you've said they basically closed their minds to working further to help with that situation. So you've put forward a solution without putting forward the alternatives. And I think Mike Russell is right, that if people are aware of the alternatives and have confidence that they're going to work, you'll get acceptance of it. But what you've put forward is creating the angst and the anger that's clearly visible around the table. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really the only point I can make on that. I think we've got the cart before the horse.
Regrettable. We have worked through these plans over the... Like, you're quite right, it's 2 years. It was the Kinnaird Review. They came up with proposals. We've had the Strategic Management Board set up by the Cabinet Secretary it's now its fourth year of operation. We've come up with various proposals at their request, and we're being guided by them as to how we can adapt and modify the surveillance programme with the now increasing budgetary constraints. In the documentation, you'll see the financial figures that we have. Mm-hmm. And these are figures that we produce on a quarterly basis for the government as part of our reporting mechanism on the grant and aid that we get. So, Mr. Ferguson, we do try to be open and clear there, and I'm a bit distressed by the fact that we're hiding something that's coming forward. But the reality is that we receive significant amounts of taxpayer funds. These funds have been reduced, and we're now on a flat funding programme, so it's effectively further cuts. We have a network that was established many years ago, and it's ragged at the edges and needs to be refreshed and enhanced. And my staff and I, who've had many, many years of service to SAC, I've done 32 years, and there's many of my colleagues around the country have up to 40 years and more. And we are distressed that we are finding ourselves working in facilities that are well past their sell-by date, and we do need to be making some hard decisions as to the way forward. And people deride us for trying to come up with other suggestions, because they don't like the idea of us changing it. Well, The reality is that, you know, we are working under extremely difficult circumstances. People are putting in well beyond sort of contractual hours in an effort to hold the thing together.
No, I don't doubt that, yes. and I've shared many of your 30-odd years with you,
yes,
as you're well aware, in various mm-hmm. different roles. Mm-hmm. But the point I think I have mm-hmm. to make, that I think has already been raised mm-hmm. to a certain extent, mm-hmm. is that if one wants to bring in changes of this nature, you've got to take people with you.
Yes.
In order to take people with you, you've got to have an acceptable alternative in place. Mm-hmm. And I come back to Inverness, that there are arguments around lots of the mm-hmm. other ones as well, mm-hmm. particularly the Auchan Crew one. I used to use that a lot myself. A great deal myself, rather too often for my financial comfort. But had I had the alternative been to go to Glasgow? I don't think so. I don't think I'd have been doing it. I live 25 miles south of Ayr as it was then. Mm-hmm. So all of that argument comes in. But on the Inverness situation, which is the really big one here, you're not taking people with you. That's the problem. Mm-hmm. It is, I think, almost as simple as that.
I think we accept that. And in my summary of the consultation, I think I made that, recognise that quite clearly. Yes, we have to think again. So thank you for that.
Before I bring in Sarah, can I just get Jim Hume to ask his question with regarding the annual budgets?
Yes.
And then Sarah Boyack.
Thanks. For those who know me, I've come from a rural background and still have nightmares about foot and mouth when it hit the south of Scotland in 2001, not just for the economy and the animal welfare, but for the mental welfare of many farmers who are still suffering to this day. Absolutely. So I'm totally opposed to what's going on today. We've heard from the NFU. They're saying that there's been no details of cost-benefit analysis or reference to any alternative options that may have been considered. We've heard that private vets could be used for doing post-mortems, and they are united in their opposition to this. Mr. Weinberg, you mentioned that there's been 10% cut in money from the government, but for the last, up until 2011, 2012, there's been no cut. It's been £3,773,000 every year from the Scottish Government-funded veterinary advisory services. Mr. Hosey, you're mentioning time and time again it's to improve services, but we're also hearing it's to do with cuts. So could we have an honest answer to whether it is purely for financial reasons, or is it for better services? And if it is for better services, nobody here has yet heard how these better services will actually be delivered. And it would also be interesting to know what would happen with the estate, a talking crew, and Inverness. Would that be sold? Has there been a situation where you've actually valued that to this point? And is this a case of perhaps selling some of the silver to pay for income?
Can we take that in two sections? I'd like to sketch the bigger picture, and Brian will respond specifically on the budget amount. I think the reference to everything that we're doing being done on the basis of providing a better surveillance, just to provide some perspective on that. The strong initiator in here is the fact that we're under budgetary pressure. So Brian will talk about that in a minute. I think what this has created is an opportunity for us to consider where we are with disease surveillance overall within Scotland. We've talked about the infrastructure, which is worn out and tired and needs reorganising, replacing, etc. But it's also an opportunity then to consider some of the things that are going on internationally from a disease surveillance point of view. So there are opportunities for us to operate in a different way. There's also, we have a world-class team in our epidemiology unit in Inverness, which has not been fully utilized in this respect in terms of analysis of data. So that's the active surveillance bit that we spoke about at the beginning. And we should be using their services more wholly. So all of the context of that is just saying that this is an opportunity for us to take stock on how things are done and to take a slightly different approach. It's not to say that what we're trying to do is to take away the services that are provided on a local basis. We're doing everything we can to try and maintain that, but make these other changes at the same time.
Okay. And with regard to the costings, the budget information is in Table 1 of the figures that you were given, and you'll see that we had a £36,000 cut in 2011-12, and then a further £300,000 cut in the following year, and then since then we've had flat funding. We were very fortunate that we were given additional supplementary income from the government, and you can see the figures there, up to £300,000-odd. And we've been told that we should not be relying on these contingency funds going forward. I should make it clear that the funding that we get from the Scottish Government, we are told about the funding going forward very much at the last minute before the new financial year starts. We would normally expect to get the figures in November, December, so we can do our planning for the financial year starting in April. I do not know the figures that we'll be working with next financial year. I understand from the press that it might well be quite late on, but we are trying to work within these limitations. So these are the figures that are reported through the system.
So just to follow up on that, you do get around about £4 million per annum for funded veterinary advisory services. Do you not think that there is a risk that you're facing an ever-decreasing circle if there's no vision for where you're going forward to? Because I don't think we've seen that. And if you're providing less of a service to less of the country, then there's a risk that the government may look even less. I don't speak for government, I oppose it, of course. You are at risk of losing your funding even more because you're providing less of a service to cover the country.
I think the one thing that we have actually had a good opportunity to do now, in the light of all the response that we've had to the stakeholder consultation, is to take stock of our vision. And I would be, particularly as I take up a new role, I understand that us being able, putting ourselves in a position where we can articulate that much more clearly to everybody, taking into consideration the disengagement that there is from some of the veterinary surgeries and so on, that is incumbent upon us to be able to do that more clearly. So we recognise that. We do have a vision for where we're going. And I think where we want to move forward with that now, it is actually about how we communicate that on an intelligent basis in order to try and get a broader engagement from everybody.
And to address the point of decreasing your footprint in Scotland does risk your chance of decreasing funding from government.
Part of the vision that we have is to do everything we can not to decrease the footprint. So in terms of availability of the facilities to do post-mortems, in other words, the man with a dead cow who's been used to being able to take it to a facility in Edinburgh, in wherever it might be, to have it attended to, trying to maintain that. So we're setting out to try and do that in everything we're thinking about. There are issues of fabric of buildings and all that sort of thing that we need to deal with. Where we believe that we can get some savings will also be in a reorganisation of laboratory facilities and a concentration of the know-how, the capital that's required in order to equip those facilities. So as we think about that in the longer term, that might be a direction of travel.
And just the very last point was, I mean, has there been work done by yourselves to value the properties at Auchincroove and Inverness for sale purposes? Or
we have got a valuation, although it's not a formal valuation, on the property in Inverness. So yes, we have got. In fact, we'll have on all of our properties. Plus we'll also have on maintenance requirements for those buildings projected over the next 10 years.
Okay, those might be quite interesting to share if possible.
So, a member for the Lothians.
Yeah. Well, I have to say, I mean, my question was really about how the responses to the consultation have changed thinking about the future of disease surveillance centres in Scotland. But I think it's been quite interesting listening to the conversation around the table, because there's obviously the challenge that private vets don't want to take over the work that you've suggested. I get the sense of people working flat out to make the existing system work, and that's not possible under the current financial envelope, but it's a contracted position. So, I mean, I am wondering, Convener, in the light of all the comments that people have made, this is partly about the financial envelope, and I wonder if this work has been contracted to SEC Consulting Limited. Given the response, the very strong response, and the knowledge around the table and having seen the submissions, is this doable to people's satisfaction given the financial envelope? And I think that's a question that we could probably spend longer being unhappy with what is being told to us
But unless that financial envelope changes or somebody has got some clever thinking about a transitional plan allowing new investment in places that are currently not fit for purpose, I can't see us being satisfied with any of the responses we might get today. And I don't see that as a Lothians member. I see that as somebody who's looking at this and thinking about farmers, who's thinking about the private veterinary world, who's thinking about training for new vets, and thinking about the crucial link between animal husbandry and animal health and welfare and the direct relationship to human health. And I think Jim's point about the disease outbreak in the early years of this parliament is absolutely spot on. Yeah. Once you're in the middle of one of these, you know, you can learn your lessons afterwards, but the human and financial costs are massive. So from where we're sitting as committee members, it's very rare for us all to be so so unified in something. And I wonder if actually this is something that we need to communicate to the Cabinet Secretary. Yeah. I wasn't expecting us to have this kind of discussion, and I think it's been quite useful.
Yeah, I think that's very fair points. And, you know, resuming my sort of more neutral role as the convener rather than as a local member in the Highlands, I think it's important that the Cabinet Secretary engages with us on the basis of the discussion that we've had today and the basis of the kinds of views that have been put forward. But it would be necessary, I think, for the Cabinet Secretary to know what the access to services point is, and secondly, what this strategic vision is, because it's impossible to tell for us at this time exactly where this is all leading, except that it's a contraction of particular services we have at present. Mike Russell.
There is a confusion, and you know, you are not going to be able to take this forward here, but there is a confusion in the overall roles within the organisation. You know, SRUC is now not going into a merger, I understand, with Edinburgh University. It has absorbed three colleges, a matter of which I have had some involvement. The relationship between the consulting arm and the university and the academic arm is at times porous, one way or the other. There does need to be a much greater clarity about the overall role of SRUC, its overall vision and its contribution. As Jim Hume has indicated, the fact that money is going one way to do the veterinary work, which is entirely legitimate. Money is going another way to do academic, to do college work, to do academic work. We need some clarity about this, because all institutions are under pressure. But the response to that pressure, and I don't think anybody, Brian, is saying that they're criticising the individuals, the response to that pressure is not always to retreat from the periphery. The response to that pressure is sometimes to say, how can we configure in a different way? And how can we look at the organisation in a different way? And I think it's time that that is the overall vision of the organisation was expressed in a way that it could be understood by Scotland.
Do you want to make sort of a final response to the... we're trying to finish by 1:30, because...
We haven't touched on marine issues, which is a fundamental question. I do need to ask those questions.
Well, OK, we should do that.
Thank you very much.
Please do.
We've received two submissions on marine issues in relation to your brief and your work, and one is from the Marine Animal Rescue Coalition and one from the Whale and Dolphin from Whale and Dolphin Conservation. And it's been highlighted, and I'll just raise three points. Firstly, that in their view that the reviews have had a terrestrial perspective, not a marine perspective, that there are EU legal obligations in relation to marine issues that need to be honoured, and I'm in no way suggesting they're not being honoured, but going forward into the future. And also, the suggestion has been made, and I'll just highlight the concern again about Inverness, that the rapid response and the animal welfare issues in relation to shooting of seals and relation to other mammals such as whales and the analysis through post-mortem there are extremely valuable. And there's a plea that at least the post-mortem aspect of that could be considered. Now, I'm saying that at least the post-mortem in relation to marine. That is not in any way to preempt the comments that have been made about the terrestrial arguments being put forward by the members. But I wonder if you could comment on those concerns.
We recognise all the concerns that you've mentioned. We've met with Scottish Government. It's a different funding stream associated with the Marine Strandings operations. It's a small team of three people that are involved in that. The facilities that they've used to date have been the same facilities that are essentially there in order to cover terrestrial mammals. So we've got one or two issues to work through, but we are working hard at trying to at making sure that we retain that operation, that team, and the services they provide in the area.
And we could also say that we've spoken with Marine Scotland, who are the funding body for that work, and made it clear that, you know, the rather short-term 1 to 3 year contracts that we tend to operate on, or we do operate on under that work. It would be better to have a longer-term plan, given all these points that you have made, Mrs. Beamish, that, you know, if we're to provide a long-term service, we really need long-term funding. And, you know, a succession of 1 to 3 year contracts does put us at a disadvantage in that kind of planning.
So would you agree that the comments about the emphasis of the review being terrestrial would imply, if you're in agreement with that, that there should be a considerable amount of further consultation on the marine aspects of this? I know you say you're speaking with Marine Scotland, but, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of stakeholders and in terms of the way forward, if your business plan and your outlook, mm-hmm. which are the terms that have been raised by one of the submissions, if those don't take into account the marine issues, then this is a cause for concern.
I think we would recognise that the focus of the consultation has been on terrestrial animals. That's fair to say. But I would emphasise that we are not neglecting that aspect. It has it has a lot of merits. The work that's been done there, it's, you know, they're, whether it be because of EU commitments, whether it be because of the quality of information, or whether indeed if you allow your mind to think a little bit further about the potential that could be achieved in that area in terms of the interface with students and bringing people into that area and the public, a broader public role, we do recognise that. So right. It's probably been looked at as a slightly separate issue to one side, but not neglected, I emphasise.
Thank you.
Finish this just now. We may be able to follow up some things in writing, but a short supplementary on the marine budget.
Very briefly, just for clarity, you referred there to additional funding from Marine Scotland. Which budget heading does that come under on the table?
Doesn't come under this one at all.
So these figures aren't an entirely accurate reflection of the income then?
No, these figures relate to the funding stream that's under the Veterinary Advisory Service budget.
Okay.
And so we get grant and aid funds, as I've explained, and we get other income, that's fee income, because the farmers and, or rather, the veterinary practitioners will pay a fee for any blood tests, worm-egg counts, post-mortems, at a subsidised rate. So it's partly funded by the laboratory fees and partly funded by the government's grant and aid. And of course, some aspects are fully funded by the government grant and aid. So the you know, specific veterinary expertise that we provide to government on new and emerging diseases, that kind of stuff will be fully funded. The work you mentioned about wildlife crime, if there's a police involvement, forensic pathology, appearance in court, you know, these are huge costs, and these, Mr. Day, are fully funded by the government.
Okay.
Just as I said, 62% of our funding is through this stream here, so this is what these figures are. So that's the grant and aid and the laboratory fees associated with that specific work.
Okay.
And 38% of our income is out with that. So that's covering the marine strandings, work that we do on health schemes, health planning, that kind of commercial, what we call commercial income, testing on dogs, cats, horses. That's out with the government funding. But we make use of the facilities so that we're able to have that greater flexibility
in response to national crisis, because we're doing these tests on a bigger scale, and we're engaging with the community, supporting veterinary practices by giving them additional opportunities to add value to their visits through doing blood testing for health schemes and the like, giving the private farmer also opportunities to add value to their livestock. And I'm sure Alec could be alert to that kind of thing, whereby we're, you know, giving health stamps and accreditation to foster the, you know, the value of the stock.
Right. Thank you. I will value reading the evidence and the discussion that's taken place. As you can gather, there are strong views. It is not personal in any way, but we would like to thank you for your evidence so far. And obviously, there's going to be further discussions about this with the SRUC, SAC, and the Cabinet Secretary. So I want to conclude this session just now by saying thank you for being with us and understand where we're coming from. Thank you. We have a future meeting on the 7th of September in Portree to begin taking stakeholder evidence on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. Like all committee meetings, public event tickets are available from the Parliament's website. And as agreed earlier, we're going to move into private session fairly rapidly. So I close this public meeting of the committee today and thank all those who are here and clear the gallery.